Ah, yes. The university. A place of knowledge. A place of enlightenment. A place to learn, grow, and further your development as a human being, striving for wisdom. A place to transmit venereal disease. A place to get hammered and stoned. A place to be ideologically indoctrinated by communists. A place to fuck basic bitches, dude bro. Wait, what?
What's going on, motherfuckers? It's Juice Boy, back from college. Whoa! It's lit! It's lit! Fortnite!
Okay, so before I go any further into this video, I need to make a few disclaimers. If you're prone to barfing, you probably don't want to watch this video. There will be images of things that might make you barf. This is your warning, because apparently a lot of you like to eat food while watching my videos. Don't worry, the next video won't have any barf-worthy moments. Next, prepare for an episode of pure bitching and moaning from me. Though if you're not a fan of the channel, then every video probably sounds like bitching and moaning, so it won't be anything new to you. This video will be mostly negative, so those who like positive, happy, fun unicorn times should probably just stop here. Third, most of my complaints are entirely personal and out of sheer disappointment with the state of humanity. Not all that factual or backed up with heavy amounts of evidence. Just personal experiences and encounters I've had. If you're just looking for straight up facts, you can skip to this part of the video. Also, because this is the internet, and if you don't constantly say positive things, you become some sort of nihilist in the eyes of the viewer, I need to make a disclosure that I do not hate people. And because it's going to sound like this throughout the majority of the video, my comments do not apply to all college students. So, not all college students is going to be a repeating phrase here. Lastly, I am not saying that you can't like anything that I'm about to trash on. And with that, let's get rolling! So freshman year of college just ended about 2 months ago, and I have to say it wasn't all that bad. I changed my major 3 times, I lost 30 pounds, so much for that freshman 15, it's the freshman negative 30 for me. My introversion has only gotten worse, and my faith in the future of humanity is pretty much gone. I don't think I have ever thought more about my own mortality in my entire life. On the most fundamental level of human existence, it's extremely demoralizing to see just how poorly the first 18 years of most people's lives set them up for college and being on their own. And I don't mean that in the sense of just being lost and not knowing how and where to fit in and all that stuff. I mean that more in the way of people having been taught absolutely no personal responsibility or good life values or a means by which to live their lives other than,
whatever dude, just going with the flow, man.
This is the motto that young people live their lives by. Fuck that motto. I look at all my peers, and half of them have absolutely no idea how to take care of themselves. Most kids spend their time getting high off all sorts of drugs, have late night parties every single day, and are busy getting drunk and fucking each other, waking up miserable and doing it all over again. That they forget they have their academics to worry about. They don't even take the time to put their garbage in the trash, and they'll just toss it on the ground somewhere. And yeah, I know. Not all college students. But there's enough that do pull off this crap, and they make themselves known. I'll get into some of the photos I've taken later on. To me, this seems to be a problem in large part of these people having received absolutely garbage parenting. Like, I can't honestly look at the way some of these people have behaved throughout the course of the last year and say to myself that they really had a good upbringing, with good parents who taught them how to be responsible adults who can take care of themselves and live a good life and make good decisions. No. These people had some of the worst parenting ever. Parents who have totally failed to prepare their children for life outside of home, and have failed to instill any sort of values in them. So couple that with the prevailing dirtbag culture that is constantly getting shoved in our faces, and you get the type of people we have now. College culture is dirtbag culture, or douchebag culture, call it whatever you want. It's a culture of decadence and stupidity, with the justification for all that being,
"Heh, come on man, we don't know any better. We're young, dude. We're gonna be in our teens and 20s for like the next 50 years, man. Who's got the weed?"
Oh, and relationships? Relationships aren't even a thing anymore. And I'm pretty sure they haven't been for a long time now. People just hook up, maybe have a fuck for the road, and then they're done with each other. That's it. There's no meaning in any of this. It's purely for shits and giggles. We have forever cemented the culture of free love amongst the youth. I asked a friend back home once how he and his girlfriend were doing, and he just flat out replied to me, "Oh no, she's not my girlfriend or anything, we're not going out." And I was pretty confused by the statement. What do you mean you're not going out? You've been seeing each other for a little over a month now, you're always hanging out with each other and going places and shopping together and buying each other stuff, and you're even fucking each other on a weekly basis. What do you mean you're not going out?
Well, I mean, it's just different, you know?
Well, what's the difference between going out with someone and what you're doing now?
Well, I mean, like, it's just different. Like, I don't know how to explain it, man. I'm sorry.
I asked him what his own girlfriend thought about the relationship, and he just said to me,
"I don't know what she thinks, but, like, we're not boyfriend, girlfriend, or anything. Like, I don't know."
I don't know? Later, he decided that he would officially ask her out on a date, and her response was,
"Well, I don't really know. I kind of just want to take it slow."
Take it slow? What the fuck does that even mean? You're already fucking each other weekly. You're already doing all this other shit together. What does that even mean? But the thing about that is, they both already knew, without saying anything to each other, and despite everything that they were doing together, that they weren't actually going out. I don't engage in pop culture and the Instagram scene and all that other social media crap and the narcissistic delicacy of the selfie, so I must be missing out on some sort of lingo that we use now. And this isn't the only time that I've heard this description when I assumed two people I knew were going out with each other.
"Oh no, we're not going out or anything."
Despite the fact that literally everything you two do with each other may as well be considered going out, but fuck it. There are no real relationships anymore. Everything is just relative. We're all just fuck buddies. That's it. Especially at college. Free love, man! From the understanding that I got, if you're actually going out with someone, there seems to be a greater degree of commitment involved. One that's above all the hanging out and shopping and buying things for each other and sneaking out at night to meet up with each other and saying I love you on a daily basis and even straight up fucking each other. It's a level of commitment greater than all of that that actually defines going out now. And apparently, until that moment, you're essentially a free agent in the relationship because there is no real relationship. You're just fuck buddies. We're all fuck buddies. Nothing more. It's literally a culture of free love. Oh, and everyone cheats. And I'm not talking about relationships anymore, though that may be just as true too. I'm talking academically. You had best believe that in the 21st century, with the amount of phone access that kids have access to in class, more than half of us are a bunch of cheaters. And I don't know how some people even do it, especially in college. In high school, it was super easy. The teachers themselves don't really care, and your classmates don't really care. Some teachers I had would even leave their tests on top of their desks, and once they left, someone would just run up to their desk and take some quick photos. My AP Comparative Government class in senior year of high school got busted because someone did this. And some teachers I've had will even review for the test by giving us the questions and answers that will literally appear on the test itself. It has never been easier to cheat. Unless schools nationwide just ban phones altogether and have someone staring at each individual student as they take tests, you had best believe that 20 to 50% of the class is cheating on this test in some way. Whether it's texting their friend who had the class beforehand on what the answers were, or what some of the questions were, or getting them to quickly take photos of the test, or somehow getting a hold of a former student's tests, or writing things down that help you on the desk, in your eraser, or on your pencil, or keeping a slip of paper in your hoodie pocket. However you do it, it has never been easier to cheat. I saw a video once of a guy who cut his pencil grip open and stuck in a piece of paper with test answers that could easily slide out of the slit through the pencil grip. Dedication to the craft of cheating. And I guess it also doesn't help when the teachers themselves are involved in the cheating. There are teachers out there, and I've had some, who really don't give a shit if you're cheating on their exams. But regardless, technology has made cheating so damn easy. So damn easy. And yes, again, I know, not all college students. Oh, and I'm not some kind of incel. I know that word's been getting popular lately. And if you're an introvert of any sort, then you're just automatically placed into this group of degenerates. From what I can tell, they're full of very lethargic nerds who want so badly to get laid that they'll condone rape and violence on anyone that refuses to give them these things. Yeah, a bunch of weirdos. So I guess I'll start talking about the dorms. There's no real good place to start with any of this. It all sucks. So you're required to live in the dorms for your first year here, unless you live within a certain proximity to the university. And I didn't really mind that rule. I can see the reasoning behind it. I mean, for most people, being ensconced in college life and college living is really important for them, because they need that community of people. Well, as I discovered throughout the course of the year, not me. A person like me does not need college for the community and the socializing and the dirtbag culture surrounding college life, or even to make friends, because God, dude, the people I have to choose from to make friends with blow. As I discovered, a lot of it is just bullshit. It's basically what you'd expect. I don't know how many times I've seen movies and TV shows and trailers of college kids acting like complete morons to not have expected something similar and along the same lines as that. Basically, it looks and sounds a lot like this. It's incredibly trashy and annoying. And I thought, well, okay, whatever, that's fine. I'm probably not gonna like it, but at least it's a roof over my head. And that's all I really care about, a roof. I'm not one who really cares much about personal comfort or convenience when it comes to my direct living quarters. I only brought with me what I can fit in 2 suitcases. Not like most people who just shove a bunch of crap in the trunk of their cars because they just have to bring their favorite cactus platform when they were 5 years old, and they just have to bring that weird-looking chair thing and all 30 brands of their protein powders and all 57 pairs of shoes they have. They just have to bring all this stuff. Me? 2 suitcases? We're good. But anyways, I got assigned a random roommate, and we were both from out of state. And I tried. I'm telling you, I tried to get to know this guy in the first week. But it quickly became apparent that we had virtually nothing in common. From personality to lifestyle choices, to damn near everything. I mean, when one of the first things the guy asks you is,
"You do any drugs? Do you drink, dude? Do you smoke, bro?"
You know this guy has other priorities in life. Now, before I changed my major 3 times, we actually had the same major. And even with that, there was no connection. I mean, there was a hard separation in background here. Now luckily for me, he wasn't a complete douchebag. He's what I'd call a silent douchebag. Where sure, outside of the room he might do all sorts of drugs and alcohol and dip and catch whatever diseases he wants, but when he was inside the room, he was for the most part quiet. Keyword is, for the most part. He tried to keep most of his dirtbag behaviors outside of the room we lived in. Tried. More on that later. But if you can't tell, we really didn't get along. Not physically or verbally most of the time, we just had absolutely no interest in each other. So we didn't talk to each other for most of the year. It would be pretty common for us to just talk to each other maybe only once every 2 weeks. Now some of you might hear that and go, "What? Once every 2 weeks?" Yeah, I'm not exaggerating that. There may have been longer streaks of time where we didn't say anything to each other. We just did not care about each other.
But wasn't that awkward?
No, not really. Again, I'm not the type of person that deeply needs to socialize and converse with people, especially with dirtbags. I can do without just fine. Now, I can't say that it wasn't partially my fault. I have a tendency to completely distance myself from people that I absolutely cannot stand, mostly due to them behaving in such a disgusting manner and having a certain way of carrying themselves that I don't want anything to do with. And after that first week, I got a pretty clear indication of who he was gonna be, which was already preparing me to just walk away from even trying to make this work. But not only that, on our first night there, as I was trying to connect with this guy that I was gonna be spending the next year with, he made it pretty clear that he wasn't interested in getting to know me either, because he also kept trying to distance himself. Physically, like just walking away as I was in the middle of talking to him. Yeah, that happened once. So couple that with his already silent douchebag nature, and I'm checking out. I don't need to waste any more of my time on this. I have better things to do. And let's just say that as the year went on, he did certain things that made me feel further contempt for him. But speaking of douchebags, let's talk about the dorm people. I really don't know where to start with this, because the dorm people themselves had an effect on the entire atmosphere of the building, and even the appearance of it. And this is part of the whole personal responsibility thing, and having no values thing, and dirtbag culture thing that I was talking about earlier. I guess I'll start with the dormitory itself. I'm not sure how old the building is, but you can definitely tell it's seen some history, primarily due to the permeating stench throughout the hallways, and in particular the hallway I was living in. For some reason, the hallway just reeked of what smelled like 40-year-old sweat and vomit stains. I mean, it just reeked. And it's not just me who thought this. Occasionally, you'd hear some dorm people walking by and say, "Yo, this hallway fucking stinks!" And these walls aren't soundproof at all, so you can hear everything. Everything. But on multiple occasions, I recall hearing a group of girls walking by and complaining to themselves, oh my god, this hallway smells like shit, yeah, like what the fuck? So everyone knows this hallway smells like shit. Now thankfully, most of the smells seem to have dissipated by around April of the school year. But that was after 6 months of having to endure the stink. And it doesn't help that all of us living in the hallway are a bunch of big sweaty dudes. That'll stink up the place good, especially if Axe body spray. God, it's like some people just sprayed the entire can on themselves. I will say though that the smell of Axe wasn't nearly as bad as it was in our high school locker rooms, where you'd have around 50 people spraying that shit all over the place. It's just a barrage of poison on the olfaction. Now much like my roommate, I tried to get to know some of the dorm people, but many of them also ended up being engulfed in dirtbag culture. Understand that there is no sense of respect for your common man. In their eyes, you don't really exist or mean anything unless you're also an active member in the dirtbag culture. Because the dirtbag culture is all that matters. Cranking my shit music all the way up to 11 at 1 in the morning? Yeah, why not? We're all dirtbags here, right? Fuck anyone else. You wanna start slapboxing shirtless in the hallways at midnight? Sure, why not? Whoa! You wanna just start screaming and yelling in the middle of the night while I'm trying to sleep? Yeah, go for it.
Labia! Vagina!
I just peed all over.
Might as well wait and swap.
It's time.
No, John,
you know what?
When we're sober and we can figure it out.
Fuck you, okay. You motherfucker.
No.
When we're sober.
When we're sober.
When we're sober.
This shit stays when we're drunk.
You know what? You're right. You get the corpse.
Exactly.
Here comes the shoe.
No, no, no.
Yeah. I'm Lord. Yeah.
Are they all here?
I am Lord. Yeah.
I am Lord. Let me in.
Now the screaming and yelling was a daily occurrence. Same goes for the loud-ass partying and constant drinking. In fact, one time, one of my neighbors was drunkenly singing to himself at 1 in the morning, and I had to open my roommate's window and yell at him to SHUT THE FUCK UP! Oh, and these people all have fake IDs, by the way. They're really not that hard to fake at all. And they even showed me a couple of the ones they made.
Check it out, Juice Boy.
In fact, my roommate took his own fake ID photo right in front of me. It's just what you do in college, you know? Academics? Eh, what's that? Huh? You don't want to act like jackasses with us? What are you, some kind of bitch? You little bitch, bruh? The personalities of the dorm people ranged from rural Oregon countryside boys, who really don't hold any rural values at all, to the dude bros that PC principal hangs out with that only pretend to be infatuated with PC culture because they just want to smash some puss.
What the fuck is this, bro? Bro, that little kid wrote that our tolerant views and fight for social justice is just a way for us to crush puss!
That's not true!
Oh, I know, bro! We're being totally victimized!
That little fucker did!
To pseudo-edgy memers who still fall in line with leftist ideology if they go a little too far in their edginess. To people who fall somewhere along the scale of silent douchebag to obnoxious douchebag. And to the other quiet people that I'd only catch a glimpse of in the hallways. They were probably in a similar situation as me and just wanted to get the school year over with so they can get the hell out of there. By far, the obnoxious kids are the most prevalent ones. And you just know that your dorm living experience was gonna be a good one when on the very first night, the RA had to call the police because of reports of the stench of weed permeating in the air.
Day one, bust out the weed, dudes!
We also had the fire alarm go off in the first week because someone was smoking weed in their room. Oh, and our RA was complete garbage. Did absolutely nothing to enforce the rules in the dormitory. He just stayed locked up in his room and let the dirtbags run the place. He wasn't all that timid during the first week of school, but after he realized that no one in the hallway cared about the rules, and after he lost the will to be an enforcer of the place, he just gave up. And sadly, I think the dorm people got the better of him too. They started harassing the guy in the local Snapchat story by taking photos of him from a distance and writing crude statements in the caption. I didn't get any screenshots, but all I can say is that it did happen. And about 2 to 3 months into the term, he quit. He just left. I couldn't get any official reasons why, nor did the university or dorm administration send out an official email or letter saying, hey, your RA just quit. I just started hearing from people in the hallway that he was gone. And that was it. I actually had an acquaintance in my foreign language class who was part of the RA association, and I asked him about the RA in my building, and all he said to me was, oh yeah, he wasn't really having a good time. I think the dorm administration didn't want to mention anything about the RA being gone because that might have created more anarchy in the place. Which, after the dorm people did come to the realization that we didn't have an RA, they just started screaming in the hallways at night,
we don't have an RA!
Whee!
Yeah, fuck the RA, man! Fuck the RA!
Yeah!
And the partying and craziness levels just increased from there. So around 2/3 of the way through fall term, we had no RA. And for all of winter term. And for about half of spring term, when we finally did get an RA replacement. But, much like the last RA, this one was just as ineffective in keeping the place calm and taming the dirtbags. Just the same non-existent presence. I do wonder though if the RA Association was having trouble finding a replacement because of the reputation of our building. Bean Hall seems to have a reputation for being one of the worst dormitories on campus. The first week of school, we had about a quarter of the people in our hallway just up and leave and transfer out to a different building. And the new people who did come in would just say nothing other than, yeah, this place kinda sucks. Though we do apparently have the best laundry facility. Sometimes I'd wait around for my laundry to finish up, and I'd overhear conversations from people who live in a different dormitory say, wow, you guys have such a huge laundry facility! Ours is so small, and I have to wait forever to do my laundry! I've heard that statement on numerous occasions. And no, I was not waiting around for my laundry because I was afraid that people would steal my clothes. I actually wasn't worried about that happening at all. I figured if anything, these people would at least leave my clothes alone. Especially since we had so many laundry machines that you'd never have to wait for one to be unoccupied. I think what happened here though is that our building is supposed to be sharing the laundry facility with the other building attached to us, Bean West. But throughout the school year, the entire building was being remodeled, so no one was living there. Which might be the reason why it felt like we had so many laundry machines. So if my theory is correct, once the renovations end, the people living in the completed Bean Hall complex are gonna start complaining about the lack of laundry machines. But back to the shitty reputation of Bean Hall. It absolutely deserves that label. And honestly, I think it just has to do with the people. The people are what turned the place into shit. There's a belief out there that if people live in a shitty looking building, then the people themselves become shitty. No, shitty people turn the place into shit and make it even worse than it already is. And that's what happened with Bean Hall.
The Bean Dorm is not as bad as it's made to sound.
Yes, it is. I don't know who this guy is, but he was either one of the dirtbags who saw nothing wrong with the shit going on in Bean Hall, or he was just one of the lucky ones who happened to live in the dorms at a specific time with decent people. But my theory is that they try to put the worst people together in one building or one hallway and separate them out that way. When you sign up for the dorm application process, you get a list of a bunch of personal preferences to check off on. And two of them include your approval or disapproval of drinking and smoking, and other lifestyle choices like keeping your room looking like shit or keeping it really loud. And I have a sneaking suspicion that the university tried to group together all the people that said they don't mind drinking and smoking and keeping their room looking like trash. And they tried to group these people together as best they could to try and contain the dirtbag. That's just what I'm thinking, because the dirtbag was alive and well in Bean Hall. And in no way better is it exemplified than in the way the people living here maintain the place. You already saw some of the garbage they throw around all over the hallways. Now let's take a glimpse into the bathrooms, where no one knows how to flush the toilet. You have to be an absolute dirtbag to completely trash the place where you and other people are living. That's what dorm people are, dirtbags. My god, if dorm people were the only people around and in charge of running the world, we'd all be so fucked. Yeah, let me just barf in this toilet and not even bother to flush it. Yeah, let me just leave my diarrhea in this toilet and go back to my room. No one will find it. Let me just dump this weird purple liquid in the toilet and leave it there. What do you mean I have to flush it? Let me just dump this black liquid into the toilet and just leave it there. Where can I throw my toothbrush away? Oh, that's right, the toilet. Yeah, they didn't catch my diarrhea last time, so I'll just leave some more in there. I have no idea if this is shrimp stir fry or shrimp vomit. I only got so close to take the photo. I wasn't inhaling. So in either situation, someone decided to either dump their food right next to the toilet, or they just barely made it to the toilet before throwing up all over the place and just decided to leave it there. More unflushed diarrhea. Now this might be actual blood in the toilet. Looks like bloody tissues. Unflushed, of course. I have no fucking clue what this is. Vomit? Food? Shit? No idea. Whatever it is, they decided they weren't going to flush it. Oh, and hey, more black liquid. This time in the urinals. We've got a half-eaten pizza in the toilet. That's nice. Someone took this photo and put it up on the local Snapchat story. Whatever it is, I'm not sure it belongs in the urinal. Oh, and I swear to God, this is a jizz stain. I swear to God. I have seen silhouettes of people jacking off in the stalls, and in this stall in particular. I swear to God this is a jizz stain. I swear to God. Someone seems to have left a trickle of shit stain on the back of the seat here. That's nice. And there was plenty of clogging going on. Deliberate clogging. I don't think there was ever a day in the dorms where I didn't see at least three toilets unflushed. Sometimes all three urinals would contain unflushed urine. It's like a competition between the dorm people to see just how many they can fill up before someone came along and flushed them. Oh, and don't forget about the sinks. Here we have someone trying to shove their cup noodle remains down the sink, and doing it again, and again. Apparently they don't realize that food chunks don't fit down the sink. Here we have more food that doesn't fit down the sink. I don't know what this is. Cheese bits? Weird chunk of something in the sink. That's nice. Hey, unrinsed beard shavings. Yeah, that's nice. I really like to see that in the sink I'm trying to use. Must have been really hard to just rinse all that with water, huh? Yeah, I really like to see that on the faucet. Every week. Here we have a faint white stain on the side of the sink, with chunks of something. Here we have what looks like chocolate-covered phlegm. Didn't bother to rinse that shit. Here we have more weird chunks of stuff in the sink. I don't know what this is either. Toothpaste. on the side of the sink. Didn't bother to clean that. Hey, that's where spoons go, along with the rest of your unrinsed food. Nuts! Here we have someone trying to shove noodles in the sink. And again, along with their napkin. That's totally where it goes. Here we have someone's unfinished chicken wing meal that they decided to leave on the counter, complete with fries, half-eaten bone, and cotton swabs. This may have been one of the most disgusting smells to have ever permeated the bathrooms. They left us in there for a whole 24 hours. The entire bathroom smelled of rotting chicken wings. I almost barfed. The smell was just so disgusting. I mean, this may have been one of the... Hey, let me just leave my candy wrappers in the sink. More trash. What the hell is this? Some weird Asian noodles? Yeah, let me just leave my Milano cookie packaging in the sink here. That's where it goes. And hey, this is nice. Someone decided that they were gonna cut their hair inside the sink. Yeah, all over the sink. And all over the wet floor. And just a little bit in the trash. One last bit of food chunk in the sink. Yummy. More black smears. More napkins. At one point, someone decided to make the end of the counter here their own personal sink, leaving their dishes, kimchi noodles, bucket, and vegetable juice here.
100% juice, huh? Juice, juice, juiced, huh?
I think they left this here for about 5 days total. Oh, and this one is a favorite of mine. Yeah, let me just put a slice of bread in the soap dispenser. I just love soap on my bread. I'll just leave it here for the janitors to clean up. Yeah. God, I feel so sorry for the janitors that worked in our building. Cleaning up after college kids on a daily basis has got to be one of the worst jobs you could do. But the people making this mess? They don't give a shit. I talked earlier about how our RA left in the first term. Well, we also had our head janitor leave too. His name was Jimbo, and this was his last year before retiring. He came around to all our rooms in the beginning of the school year to tell us not to put stuff that doesn't belong in the bathroom in the bathroom. But no one listened. No one cared. They just fucked the place up. Rumor has it that he was so fed up with the way we fucked the place up that he transferred over to a different building. But again, no one cared. Him leaving didn't change anything, or make people realize, yeah, maybe we shouldn't fuck the place up. No, that never happened. They kept fucking the place up. This doesn't exist. Also on the first day of move-in, Jimbo told us not to put food in the trash cans in the bathroom, or else they'll have to give us a 24-hour notice to take the food out. And if the food is still left in there, they'll have to fine everyone $50. Well, in the very first week, someone said, fuck it, and put their food in the bathroom trash. The next day, we got a 24-hour notice. Now, luckily, someone got the food and put it in a different trash. But I know for a fact that it wasn't the person who put the food in there in the first place. Because I overheard a couple of dude bros in the hallways begging one of their friends to take the trash out because they didn't want to be fined.
Oh, dude, could you please take the trash out? I really don't want to be fined, man. Oh, fuck you, dude, fine.
And this happened about 4 times, and not once do I believe that the person responsible for putting the food in the trash actually took their food out. Now, I wasn't really all that concerned about this, because I figured someone would eventually squirm under the pressure of paying a $50 fine, which that did happen every time. But I guess someone else was having a really serious mental breakdown over this, because at one point someone decided to write a note saying, "Whoever the fuck keeps leaving food in this trash, you will pay for all our fines! Put your trash in your own fucking trash can, lazy fucks!" I don't think that piece of paper really scared the person responsible to taking the trash out. But someone took the trash out. This ended up happening so many times that the janitors just had to take out the trash can completely. We did not have a trash can from that point on. We still had these wall-mounted trash cans though, just not the big one on the floor. But one of the ways that some of the dorm people would go around the rule and not technically put their food in the trash was to just leave it right next to the trash.
It's technically not in the trash, bruh. Come on, you can't find me. Go fuck yourself, bruh.
I think it was in my censored unicorn video where I mentioned how janitors contribute a lot more to society than they get credit for. And the dorms are an excellent reason as to why. Imagine how much more of a shithole this place would be if we didn't have janitors. And if no one came around to clean up the mess that the dorm people make. God, fuck dorm people. But after Jimbo left, we got a new set of janitors. And these guys didn't seem to care to enforce the trash in the bathroom rule at all. So everyone just went back to shoving more food in the trash. Fine free. Now aside from the shit they leave in the toilets, urinals, and sinks, one time they left their food trash just outside the bathroom door for some reason. They left it there for 24 hours. After a while, someone grabbed it and moved it over to the janitor's room. Yeah, let the janitor take care of it. I didn't get a photo of the change in position though. Sometimes I didn't have my phone on me, and other times there were people around, and I didn't want to be seen taking photos of trash or shit in the toilets. But I had to document all this to you so you people know what goes on in a college dorm. My phone was just filled with shit photos for the past year, collecting all this evidence of the crap that goes on in here. I knew I was gonna be making this video back when I first started this channel. This video has been a year in the making. But one of the easiest ways to identify a douchebag, if not by the way they dress, is by the way they talk. Let's just say that if part of your daily vernacular includes words like lit, bumping, hip, hella, dope, or dope ass, and you're using those words unironically, you might be a secret douche.
It's lit!
Alright, what's up, guys? Alright, what's up, guys? We are going to make a video on the room. Our hall is pretty, it's always bumping and stuff. So underneath, there's also hella space. So, I mean, outside's pretty dope. So this is my view, and it is a pretty dope view, I would say. There's always, like, music bumping. Like, this is definitely the best place to live because our whole hall is lit. Wait, totally have some dope-ass lighting.
Welcome to the U of O.
We got a crazy weekend ahead, and we're gonna show y'all how we get lit.
Go!
Also, don't buy products from Barstool. Another key word to know about for any elderly folk watching this video, if a college kid or high schooler says someone they know is chill, that generally means they like to shove a bunch of drugs and alcohol into their bodies and like to go to parties all the time.
He's so chill, dude.
Which was pretty much what a lot of Bean Hall did. One time I overheard a conversation going on in the hallways where one guy asked the other where his roommate was, and he just responded,
"Oh yeah, dude, he rented out an Airbnb so he can do a bunch of cocaine and shit."
Really?
Yeah, dude.
There was no sarcasm in his voice. He was serious, in the most nonchalant way. So I guess we had some guy snorting up cocaine somewhere. I don't think I'm ever going to rent out an Airbnb after hearing this story. And I'm pretty sure this Airbnb was always in use by this guy, because I'd constantly hear about it being the place to do hard drugs and alcohol and fuck some sluts. College! Hooray! Also, I think another synonym for douchebag is fuckboy. And it has to be spelt like this. Not like this, this. We've got a lot of fuckboys here. Thick fuckboys. I think a good example of the dichotomy between a regular person and a douchebag is in these two Snapchat posts that went out in the local story. Remember to take care of yourself before and during finals week. It is good for your brain when you relax and do something enjoyable before a test. No one should study late night before an exam. Go to the rec, play a board game, read a book for fun. And the response to this being,
"Hey Dan, go fuck yourself, man, how about that?"
I think most of the dorm people are just one step away from reaching the Logan Paul levels of douchebaggery. They're just almost. Oh, and going back to the bathrooms, after you clearly saw how utterly disgusting this place is, and the amount of disgusting bodily fluids this floor sees on a daily basis, can you believe that some of these people will go around and walk barefoot on this floor? Yes, barefoot. I have seen so many people go barefoot in this bathroom. On this food-stained, dirt-stained, shit-stained, semen-stained, urine-stained floor. And they take those shit-stained feet back to their room and get all that nice bacteria all over their room and all over their beds. My god, it's bad enough that your shoes do that on a regular basis. It's no wonder the levels of disease are so high on college campuses. These people are disgusting. So we can't flush toilets, we leave vomit, shit, and other human excrements out in the open, and we track all these shit particles with us wherever we go. It's no wonder why our hallway reeks. Just imagine decades of the same crap going on in here. If you've ever listened to the song Mile End by Pulp, the lyrics of that song are very accurate to what the dorms were like at times. The lift is always full of piss, the fifth floor landing smells of fish. Not just on Fridays, every single other day. Oh, it's a mess, alright. Yeah. But I also found out that I wasn't the only person disgusted by people who went around barefoot in this bathroom. I was in the bathroom one day washing my hands after taking a dump, and one of the dorm people came in with his water filter, and it looked like he was just gonna rinse out some old water, when all of a sudden he decides that instead of pouring the water down the drain, he's going to splash it all over the bathroom floor. And then he looked at me and said, "Let's see those motherfuckers walk barefoot now!" I'm not kidding you, this actually happened. I can't say that I agree with his choice of throwing water all over the bathroom, but weirdly enough, that guy was the person I probably had the best relationship with inside the dorms. But I guess he was even more disgusted with the barefoot people than I was. Not even the water fountains were safe from the disgusting dorm people. For some reason, instead of brushing their teeth in the bathroom sink like normal people, some of them decided that they were going to brush their teeth in the water fountain. So after a while, the water fountain would start to see toothpaste smears all over it. I don't need to be drinking water from a place that people are spitting their toothpaste in and around. Now that wasn't even the primary reason why I stopped drinking water from the fountain. During the first week of school, I had a couple sips from the water fountain and noticed a weird taste. It wasn't the blood-like taste that many people experience, but it wasn't good, so I just stopped drinking the water from the fountain. But after some time, I started hearing people in the hallway say to themselves,
"Hey yo, does the water fountain taste like lead?"
Oh, you think so too? Yeah, man, this tastes like fucking lead.
I heard the lead comment on two other occasions. So yeah, I wasn't the only person who tasted something weird about the water. So I completely stopped drinking from that water fountain, or any water fountain on campus. And from that point on, I only drink water from bottles. Yeah, I know, I traded drinking lead for drinking leaching plastic. What can you do? Now, one positive thing about the bathrooms is the condition of the stalls themselves, because compared to high school, most people in college seem to have finally grown out of doing wall writings. In high school, the second you walk into a stall, you're gonna see the N-word written all over the place, and believe in Satan, or some antichrist symbol, or someone will write something about how Daquan got his dick sucked by Jessica, or something stupid like that. And since the stalls themselves were made out of some weird plastic material, you'd also see burn marks from kids who'd spend their time in the bathroom melting the walls with their lighters. Oh, and of course there's dick drawings. In college though, no writings. Or at least it's been extremely reduced. These were the only ones I found in our dorm. Please do not flush these items.
Urine.
To prevent colds, the flu, and other infections,
do not
wash your hands. And speaking of overhearing things that go on in the hallway, one time I heard someone say,
"Hey, do you want to smell my sweaty underpants?"
And then 5 seconds later, all I hear is, I guess he smelled the underpants. One time I was in the bathroom taking a leak when I overheard from the showers,
"I'm gonna get some more vodka. I downed that vodka, bruh."
So I guess some of the dorm people also drink in the showers. That's not surprising. Yeah, the showers also weren't safe from the trashing of the dorm people. Though compared to the bathrooms, it wasn't quite so bad. Sometimes I'd walk in and see beer cans in the shower. Other times I'd see someone's shampoo products everywhere because someone decided to start squeezing their shampoo liquid all over the curtains. Sometimes there'd be random trash on the bench, sometimes on the soap stand, sometimes on the floor. Sometimes you'd find straight dirt on the shower floor, or other times you might find straight trash. Here we have a napkin for some reason, and some translucent plastic wrapping along with the ripped off top of some other package. Thanks for leaving your trash in the showers, guys. One time some moron left his laptop in the shower. I'm not surprised. It wouldn't surprise me either if someone decided to give it some water damage. It was gone the next day, so I'm not sure what happened to it. I think the worst place to live inside the dorms is right in front of the shower room. Sometimes when I was going to take a shower, I'd find the door inside the room closed. Now usually it's open, but I didn't think much of it. Then after a while I realized, oh wait, it's probably the person living right across the showers closing the door. You know why? Well, because the dorm people will bring their speakers into the bathrooms and blast their rap music all the way up to 11. Yeah, that's a reason to close the door. And you can hear their music on the entire floor. Nothing is quiet in this building. And if I can hear it from my room, which was on the opposite side of the showers, just imagine what it was like for the guy living right in front of the showers. Yeah, the music was always bumping, dude bro. Some shit music. Probably 50% of the time, I'd come back to my room and hear some hot garbage playing. What is this? Every day, someone, somewhere, is blasting some of the latest hot garbage from Lil Gucci Gangbang, or whatever rappers are hip right now. I have never heard Rockstar from Post Malone more in my entire life. Every day, someone's playing that and they have it turned up to 11. Hot garbage! Now, another disclaimer I need to make is that I do not hate rap music. I hate the rap music that's been coming out in the last 2 decades, but not the entire genre itself. Now, I don't like the culture that surrounds the genre, because it keeps getting a lot of people killed and ruining their lives. Stay away from thug culture, people.
When I grow up, I'm gonna be a rapper and a gangster. Just like you.
No, see. You could be a rapper, but you can't be a gangster. You don't want to be a gangster.
But not all the songs that have come out in the history of the genre are terrible. Just the stuff coming out now with Yizzy Yachty, Thuggo Thotty, Crack Cocaine. I'm a much bigger fan of earlier rap, from the 90s and backwards. Where even compared to today's rap, there just seems to be more integration of actual instruments instead of just tapping on a tin pan and dropping a bass every 3 seconds. The music from this era is actually fun. I like this song by Eric B and Rakim. Actually, I like it a lot. It's really different than most rap I've ever heard. One of my favorites. This song's alright. I'm not a fan of the entire album, but I do appreciate the production that went into it. It's very different. I think anything on Grand Theft Auto San Andreas' playback FM radio station is good. You can find that playlist on YouTube. Though I think even the majority of those songs might technically be considered hip-hop over rap, I don't really know my rap genres. It seems like R&B, hip-hop, and rap all get fused into the same thing at times. Oh, and now there's also a thing called trap music? No, not that kind of trap. Honestly, I have no idea what any of this is, or the differences between them all. The only thing I can distinctively point out is that hip-hop and R&B just tend to be more fun. Modern-day rap and trap both sound like the same thing from what I've heard. Hot garbage! So the further back you go, the better. I like this song, this one's good, and I like this one. But I cannot stand the culture surrounding the music. The fuck bitches get money culture, especially in the music videos. What the hell is this garbage? What is this? Is this really cool? He's doing some weird dance in the toy section of a supermarket. This is not cool. What the fuck did you do to your face, man? Is this attractive now? I started getting a headache listening to the music while looking for footage for this video. I'll take whatever it is these dudes are listening to over most modern day rap music.
God damn it!
And I know he's got this reputation for being some kind of softy, but out of all of them, Drake seems to make the least trashy music videos. Though not always. Now, I personally don't listen to rap music all that often, just a very small set of songs. I prefer stuff from Joy Division, New Order, The Cure, The Clash, Depeche, Violent Femmes, The Doors, Pink Floyd, David Bowie, and a bunch of others in and around these genres from the time period. Mostly music from the last century. These are probably all rock bands that I can say for a certainty that I like more than 3 songs from any one of them. It's very rare for me to like an entire album from a band or group. And I'm not much of a fan of AC/DC or Led Zeppelin all that much, other than Immigrant Song. I used to like their music a lot more as a kid, but now I think a lot of their music falls more into the generic rock for me, probably because their music is just way too overplayed in media. Though I like the Two Cellos rendition of Thunderstruck though. That's awesome. And I'm not really much a fan of metal music, mostly because a lot of it just sounds like incoherent noise over something with an actual tune to it. Even a popular group like Rammstein I don't really like that much. Between these two, who get compared often, I'll take Laibach over Rammstein any day. I honestly have not found a single Rammstein song that I like over the stuff that Laibach makes. I'll take Laibach's Transnational over Du Hast any day. And I've been told that Transnational sounds like terrible demon music. Oh, but I do like a couple of Rob Zombie's stuff. He's more fun metal, though. I have a much better taste for industrial music. Now, they don't really make industrial music like they used to. It's gotten heavily blended in with dubstep and EDM nowadays. Which, I prefer the old-fashioned banging on pots and pans over a dubstep beat. But some industrial bands that I like, which you may have already heard some of their music being played in my end credit sequences, include Ministry, Revolting Cox, Skinny Puppy, Nitzareb, Test Department, Frontline Assembly, Front 242, and in some regards you can also include Nine Inch Nails in there. Though I hear now that their stuff is being classified in the subgenre of industrial metal. So, yeah, that's another thing about music classification. There are so many different ways to classify music now that I don't even know where to categorize certain groups or songs that I like. Like, I can't just tell people that I like rock. I have to tell them that I like alternative rock, or hard rock, or acid rock, or psychedelic rock, or progressive rock, or punk rock, or post-punk rock. There's all these different ways to categorize now that I can't keep track. But I guess I prefer less of rock, and more of these other subgenres. And with industrial music, I like both industrial metal and industrial rock. So from the way I understand it, something along the lines of Ministry's So What is a good place to start for industrial metal, and Attack Ships on Fire by Revolting Cox is good for industrial rock, whatever any of these things are. Cabaret Voltaire is another interesting industrial band, though a lot of their stuff would probably be more on the experimental side of industrial. I have yet to meet anyone else that shares my liking for industrial music. Oh, and for those who keep asking, what song is that in the outro? I tell you in the outro. It's right there. It's always been right there. I also like some old soul tunes. It's nice to listen to when you're just hanging around. I also like music that to most people can't even be considered music at all, and just more strange noises. Not noise like hardcore metal static, but noise that doesn't really form music over just being a mesh of sound effects. One group in particular that I like is Negative Land, and their song Time Zones. That's a classic, and it's also hilarious.
Do you know how many time zones there are in the Soviet Union?
It's not even funny. That's ridiculous.
Do you know how many...
It's not even funny. That's ridiculous.
Do you know how many...
That's ridiculous.
Do you know how many times...
That's ridiculous.
And the type of experimental music that I enjoy doesn't have to follow one genre over the other. I think the movie Twin Peaks Fire Walk With Me has one of the best film scores that I've ever heard. And that's all just weird, distorted horror noises. This movie may just have one of my favorite scores of all time. And it's all scary music. Trainspotting has probably got one of my favorite collections of soundtracks. As some of you have already noted, I use a popular song from the movie as my main background music. The movie Drive also has a good soundtrack. Now, I think the current state of music is not good, at least with new things you hear on the radio. But with that said, we have never had access to a bigger library of music in the entire history of the planet. So if you don't like anything coming out today, there's a whole catalog of stuff from the past that you can find, or more obscure groups that can be easily found. I think the best type of music coming out nowadays is just instrumental music. Any instrumental song will probably work for me. I'll take instrumental rap over rap with vocals to it. I was also pretty late to this particular music scene, but I'm also one of those weirdos that unironically likes vaporwave. The wave genre is also one of those genres that seems to have 50 different subgenres. There's synthwave, which I think a lot of synthwave is too derivative of 80s synthpop, but I think it also acts as the head genre. Then there's vaporwave, and then chillwave, which I generally prefer. Then there's also future funk and darkwave. There's also retrowave, which I think is synonymous with synthwave, so it's still mostly just 80s rehash. And I've heard this one being used too. New disco. Yeah. I think the song I played in the last video's end credits is technically considered chillwave. And I do like this EP by Perturbator, especially the song Corrupted by Design. And I believe this one is considered darkwave? And I think darkwave is also synonymous with cyberpunk? I don't know, man. Oh, and forget modern pop music. God awful. This woman produces trash. She's also a trashy person. What great role models we have today. Really promoting the best of behaviors. This is what children have to look at today.
They're just being themselves, Juice Boy. How dare you think you have the right to criticize their way of life, you man!
Their way of life sucks and produces a terrible influence on kids who have become ensconced in a culture of smut and narcissism. Mix that with social media culture and you're fucked. You know people are getting plastic surgery now to look like Snapchat filters? You know how obsessed people are with looking perfect on camera these days? The only reason why I have Snapchat is to keep in contact with friends from high school, but swipe over to the news side, and you're instantly dropped into all the worst aspects of our smut, filth, and self-obsessed sex culture. This is what the kids are looking at, and there you get to see what all the pretty girls are doing with all their pretty Snapchat filters. You got the duck face, the tits, the ass. It's all such a self-obsessed look at me culture, and this is what teenagers stare at every day. Oh yeah, girl, you get that filter, yeah. Make sure those eyes are popping, girl. Oh yeah, get that duck face in there, girl. Yeah, everyone likes that, yeah. Oh yeah, girl, show it all. Got the big eyes filter going and the tits popping. Oh yes, girl, out in the streets looking perfect with the filters. Aw, hell, it's lit now. Get those filters, girl. Perfection all the way. Aw, yeah, got the cute filter and don't forget to perk your lips up. Ha! Oh yes, perfect. Just dance around and stare at yourself in the camera. Oh god, that's just perfect, yeah. Yeah, just stick your tongue out, yeah, and put it back in because no one wants to see that. But keep staring at yourself with that perfect filter, girl. Just keep staring at yourself. Finesse that Snapchat dysmorphia, girl. Finesse it. Duck face! Filters at Disneyland. Oh, get your friends some filters too. Yeah!
Why don't they stop staring at themselves? Oh, God. So stupid.
And now imagine how many girls stare at this shit every day and say to themselves how fucking ugly they are because they aren't the perfect Snapchat filter models. There's a reason why we're killing ourselves at an increased rate now. It ain't looking good. And it doesn't matter how many times people have to literally keep saying, "You don't have to be perfect," or "There's perfection and imperfection." That saying has no effect on young people who are ensconced in this culture of looking pretty on camera and looking like the perfect human being every single day. Hell, even people who say these phrases are themselves still likely to spend around 10 minutes trying to get the perfect picture of their face. It's insane.
A recent study by London-based Royal Society of Public Health found that Instagram is the worst social network for mental health. Researchers found that a desire to take perfect, sugar-coated images of one's own life in an attempt to gain likes, followers, and keep up with one's peers only increased mental issues such as depression, anxiety, and feelings of FOMO.
But going back to the shitty pop music, Thoughty 2 made an interesting case as to why modern pop music sucks. A summation of that video is that basically lyrical intelligence has decreased, the diversity of timbre in music has decreased, harmonic diversity has decreased, and everything is louder, dumber, sounds the same, and a lot of it is being written by the same two people. And I'm not saying that there aren't good songs made from this century. I think this might be my favorite hit song of the 21st century so far. And there's a bunch of other good stuff. It's just that a lot of modern pop is trash. And these days, you'd be hard-pressed to find anything good on the radio. These two songs may have been the last gems that I've heard on the radio. So radio may be dead, but there is a slew of good stuff to be found around the hidden corners of the internet. A slew. And aside from just plain instrumental music, I think video game soundtracks are where a lot of the good stuff can be found. Hotline Miami has a popular soundtrack collection that you might like. I used the main menu song as the outro for my Spam Gangs video. And The Crew has an awesome main menu song. Yeah! If you know any songs that you think I might like, feel free to type it down in the comments section. I'm always looking for good music. Alright, that's about it with my thoughts on music. Back to the shithole. So aside from the blaring rap every day, you had best believe that everyone was getting hyped up on drugs and alcohol. And again, I don't even know why we have an RA if nothing gets enforced around here. Their position is a total joke. Whenever an RA smells weed in the hallways, all they do is put up a tiny piece of paper in the hallway saying, "We smelled weed around here." Yeah, really, that's it. I'm sure that'll do something. Sometimes the fire alarm would be triggered because some moron was smoking in their room or in the hallways. That happened a lot more often once our first RA left. I'd walk into the bathroom sometimes and just get a strong scent of weed in the air. Goddamn druggies. So now we had the stench of 40-year-old vomit and weed in the hallways. In fact, one time, within the first month of fall term, someone knocked on my door and I opened it to see two confused hippies that utterly reeked of weed. So I figured they were probably my roommate's friends or something and looking for him. But we just stared at each other for 3 seconds. They weren't saying anything, and I started thinking to myself, okay, what the hell do you want? And then finally, after awkwardly staring at each other for 3 long seconds, one of them speaks up and says, "Hey, you got some gas?" Now I misheard him at first and said, "Do I smell any gas?"
Nah, man, do you have any gas?
Gasoline?
Nah, man, gas, like, you know, weed?
Oh my, so this was also my first time ever hearing the nickname gas for weed. But apparently, even after seeing my confusion on the subject, they still wanted to press me for some weed. No, I don't have any weed, sorry. And I figured they would just leave after that, but the dirtbag followed up with,
"Oh, okay, but do you know anyone else around here that has gas?"
Oh my, the whole time inside of my head I was thinking to myself, do I look like someone who'd be peddling weed or would even want to know anyone peddling weed? I used to know some real weed junkies back in high school, but they just got so obnoxious for me to put up with anymore that I completely dropped all contact with them. I'm just gonna say this about weed. Stay away from it. It impairs your memory, thinking, and basic cognitive functions. That's from the National Institute on Drug Abuse. And from what I've seen, you start smoking weed, you start doing this with your face more often. I don't know what the hell it is about weed, but everyone I knew in high school who were hardcore weed smokers would always have this look on their face. The weed face. I don't know what the hell this is, but they always did it. I swear to God. But besides that, most hardcore smokers I've met are extremely obnoxious people, and they love to do the weed face. Now that said, I think it should probably be legalized across the country. Fuck it. It's not like banning it has done any good, and we already know how that works. But it's your own prerogative to decide for yourself whether or not you want to ruin your life or not. Oh sure, cigarettes will kill you, but weed'll ruin your life. And I'd rather kill myself before I ruin myself. So back to the story. He asked me if I know anyone else in the hallway that sells weed. And I just wanted to get this guy out of my face so I can breathe again. So I just tell him, "No, I don't, sorry."
"Oh, okay, man."
And that was that. God, they smelled like shit. Like the stench of fresh cat urine straight into my nose. Now after I closed the door, I whipped my camera out and started recording. So apparently, these guys were going to go around door to door and ask everyone in the hallway if they had any weed, and I was the first person they asked. And judging from that conversation, it sounds like they already tried asking the guy who walked by. Dirtbags. Now later on in the day, there was a basketball game going on next door, so there was a local Snapchat story event for it. And I was just scrolling through seeing what was going on at the game, when all of a sudden, this image pops up in the story. Looks like he got his weed. One time I was in my room around midnight when I overheard someone saying,
"Well, I gotta get more fucked up. I'm already drunk, so now I gotta smoke some marijuana. You got a lighter, bro?"
Meanwhile, back on the East Coast.
"Do it. Do it. This nigga about to burn $100, bro. He's really burning $100, bro. What's going on, bro? Bro, that's a Benjamin, bro. What the fuck are you doing? This nigga's crazy, bro. He's about to start a fucking fire in this building. Dude, he's real shit. Dude, stomp it out. Stomp it out. Dude, what the fuck? Stomp it out. Stomp it out. Stomp it out right now. Stomp it out. Stomp it out. Dude, stomp it out. Make sure it's all gone. You're a fucking animal.
So my roommate, he's wild. He burns $100 bills for fun. He's a mess. Sloppy. But boy, does this man have some money. I'm swearing up and down. He's Pablo Escobar of the era, bruh. Pablo freaking, the Indian Pablo Escobar. This man's in Bangladesh driving Teslas, man. I don't know what the hell he be doing, but dude, this guy needs to be on a no-fly list or something. This dude's crazy, bruh. This dude's crazy. I give it 5 months before he ends up in the New York penitentiary. This man was ordering drugs to our dorm room like it was no ordinary mail. Postal service coming up and packages, and he'd go down, leave them in there for a week in a college dorm, and he would go and get it a week later and open it up, and it would be like a fucking drug bust in the goddamn room, bruh. It's some crazy shit. Bruh, I've never met a more wild nigga than when I met my roommate. This guy, he's a different breed of human, dude. He's living like a king, bruh.
Now, aside from the weed, there was also some heavy cigarette usage, and particularly by the Chinese students here. We have a big Asian population on campus, and a majority of the kids come from China. So in the beginning of the school year, you just see a bunch of squished Chinese cigarette packages scattered all over the ground. As the school year went by and they depleted whatever supply they brought with them, you'd see less litter. But I've never really understood how an institution can proclaim about themselves that they're smoke-free. This is another one of those sayings that doesn't really mean anything. We banned smoking, therefore we're smoke-free! No you're not. And this proclamation doesn't mean anything. The people in my dorm building would even trade Marlboros for Gushers. So you'd often hear, "Hey man, I got a pack of Marlboros. You got Gushers?"
I got a couple packs here. Two packs for one cig?
So this seems to be the exchange rate for cigarettes. Two packs of Gushers for one cig. Oh, and of course there's a big vaping community on campus, which I'll tolerate that more than I do weed. If you're gonna smoke anything, you wanna look good while doing it. Like General Ripper here in a cigar. And then you wanna start talking about your life essence and the purity of bodily fluids.
I can no longer sit back and allow communist infiltration, communist indoctrination, communist subversion, and the international communist conspiracy to sap and impurify all of our precious bodily fluids.
You don't want this.
You got the gas, man? Yeah, man. Hey, dudes, I got the Gushers. Oh, that's so lit, dude. Oh, I'm starting to get the munchies.
So if you want to party with Juice Boy here, bring some cigars, some Krabby's ginger beer, and some nice chairs to sit on, and we'll talk. I'll talk about anything. Now that's a party. But lastly, of course, is the drinking. You've got cheap beer, cheap wine, cheap vodka, all that stuff. And the fake IDs in order to get it, as expected. And there was no real attempt from the dorm people to hide any of this. Sometimes I'd walk in the hallway and just see some crushed beer cans on the floor. And most of the time, if you hear anyone up from 1 to 4 in the morning, they're drunk. One time I was in the bathroom taking a leak, and it was probably around midnight or 1 in the morning, and I went over to wash my hands, and one of the dorm people walks in and says, "Hey Juice Boy, how you doing?" And I told him I was doing fine, and then he says, "That's great, man." And then he walked over to the stall and just started puking, just throwing up for the next 2 minutes. He was having your average drunken Friday night with the other dorm people. Now the funny thing is, 3 months later, in nearly the exact same way, the same thing happens. I'm taking a leak, go over to wash my hands, and he comes in again and says, "Hey Juice Boy, how you doing?" And I told him I was doing fine, and then he says, "That's great, man." And then he walked over to the same exact stall and Now the best part was that this time he followed up his barfing with some sort of plea for help.
Why do I do this to myself, Juice Boy? Why do I do this to myself?
And I just walked out of there, the same way I did 3 months ago. This same guy in particular was always barfing. You can hear someone throwing up from anywhere on the floor, even from your own room. I got a recording of him barfing too. At least this guy flushed his vomit, unlike the other people. Growing up for me has been nothing but a long observation of the fact that many of my peers cannot take care of themselves, and many are hopelessly stupid. I've always gotten along much better with people who are many years older than me, primarily because they talk and behave in a way that clearly shows their life experience and level-headedness, and they don't go spending their time asking around for Shaniqua's nudes because damn, that girl's thick. There is an expectation as a young person to act like a moron, objectively, and society excuses this kind of behavior. Subjectively, you're just doing all this stuff because it's fun, man! Living the dream! Having a sick time! Have some fun, bro! You're young! But in reality, you're engaging in a squalor of behavior and acting like morons.
What are you, morons?
By and large, society does not train you anymore to grow the hell up or do something productive. Honestly, we've been postponing adulthood for years now. We have man-children out in the streets. No one is teaching us to grow the hell up, and especially not the dorm people's parents or college culture in general. You're wasting time that can be spent doing more productive things, or developing your capacity to grow as a person, or go and take the initiative to learn something new. But this culture of pure indolence and decadence heads towards entitlement and narcissism, to the point where students now start complaining because the teacher won't let you use the calculator on your iPhone on a math test, because you were careless and forgot your calculator. Or you complain because you want the dictates of the profession you're trying to enter to cater to you, instead of you acclimating to the profession or the learning environment. Well, I'm more of a hands-on learner, so I want you to cater to me and change the entire layout of your course to fit what I want.
I'm a very bright person, but I do not do well in an academic setting. I think that adding some of these touchy-feely and interactive classes, I mean, I got through a chemistry class because I had an instructor who saw that, you know, the book was hard for me, so the lab part was the part I could excel in. I think this is very important to, you know, not all of us are book learners.
Well, you know, I could say that I also have a high opinion of myself, and I'm not very good at dancing, but I really don't think that ballet schools should be adjusted to take for people like me. People like me shouldn't be in ballet. You have to realize too that it's not a question of what you like or what you're good at. There are requirements in the world that if you're going to build bridges across the river, you have to know a certain amount of math if you don't want those cars to fall into the river as the bridge collapses under them. And if you want doctors who can cure people, you're going to have to have people who know chemistry, whether they like it or not. So we don't have the option of just doing whatever happens to feel good to us.
Or you start complaining because the teacher doesn't want you to charge your phone into the outlet in the classroom. And you start bitching and moaning when you should have taken care of that crap earlier and waste time arguing with the teacher.
Oh, you mean I'm supposed to take personal responsibility, dude? What are you, some kind of nerd? What are those?
I went to a pretty ghetto middle school and high school in Northern Virginia, so I've seen a lot of trashy students. None of this behavior is new to me. This type of self-entitled complaining and lack of personal responsibility, or even discipline amongst many people that I've seen on a daily basis and all around social media, is one of the reasons why I think the lifespan of this country is running out, and fast. I am very pessimistic about the future. We've successfully created a culture of completely self-obsessed jackassery, and there's plenty more to go. I don't think I met a single person in my class who was remotely interested in their major, or had anything significant to say about their interest in it, or even devoted most of their time towards trying to master it. Oh sure, I've met a few upperclassmen who are more committed to their major, but it's like there's this expectation at college that your first year is supposed to be spent acting like a complete moron. You're not really supposed to be taking any of this seriously.
Let's just smoke some weed and fuck some bitches! That'll do.
Hey, what about my education? Hey, what about my future? Do you people ever think about that?
Psh, what a fag.
There's no sense of seriousness at a university, especially not in freshman year. And that was my biggest mistake, expecting more people to be taking this seriously, especially with the constant media barrage of, college is good, go to college, educate yourself, college is so good. No, none of that makes any impact.
Listen, Juice Boy, I just need to get this chick to fuck me, alright? If she fucks me, then we're good, alright?
What kind of life metric is this? My friend back home puts this issue in a much better way.
Alright, dude. Alright, look, man. College has, like, changed me for real, dude. Like, high school, I took everything, like, I just took a laid back type of vibe to high school. And when I get to college, there's, like, thousands and thousands of dollars over my head, dude. Like, thousands and thousands of dollars. And, like, people decide to come here and go to a party and then come back and go to class and do the bare minimum and then try to study during finals week, try to study all the material that they didn't even care to learn during finals week. You see how much sense that makes? Like, colleges know kids don't think far enough to understand what's going on. So they just place this platform for these kids to come here and just waste their money. And before you know it, they're in debt. And the colleges don't really care. They're just here for the money. And whatever money they spend it on, it's just more for infrastructure than more than anything else. Maybe they might have a couple new labs here and there, but most of their money goes to the infrastructure just so they can make it marketable for kids to come to their college and make more money. That's just how I see it. And if you just come to college and do the bare minimum, knowing that you're going to be in debt, you might as well not come to college. You might as well just go to a vocational school, go learn how to be a plumber. If anything, if I didn't decide to go to college, I would have just tried to become an electrician or a plumber, because even that makes like 60K a year. And that's even just coming straight out of high school. Like, people don't understand that there's other options rather than just come to college to party. Like, stop living short term. It's not going to get you anywhere. If you live short term, your ideas are going to be short term. Your life's going to be short term. And you say, yeah, live life to the fullest. But how are you going to live life to the fullest when everything you think is short term? Like, it doesn't make sense to do that. I just think people should take college more seriously. They should like actually try to get the higher level education and do the best you can. I know I'm not saying everybody should go shoot for a 4.0, then make themselves a nerd at this point or a neef and just stay inside. I'm just saying, like, try to do the best that you can to your own ability. Don't come here doing the bare minimum. You're just wasting money and you're wasting time. And nobody wants to be wasting time, because time is a virtue. And once we graduate out of college, we're going to be doing things that we like doing for like 40 plus years. What's the sense in you coming here not to achieve that goal? You know what I'm saying?
Yep. And I get that people who are in college right now don't want to hear this. I get that I sound like an old asshole. I get that. But some of you people need to grow the hell up. Do you realize you're at a university? Do you understand what a university is? What you're supposed to do here? What the expectation of you being here is? I mean, I'm not sure that anyone in my hallway even read a book this entire year. I seriously doubt that. Especially not with the way they carried themselves on a daily basis. Whatever a university once was, it's no longer that. It's a place to get baked, party, and go broke.
There is no point trying to run people through institutions that they have very little interest in. And that they may not be suited for. In fact, I would argue that one of the problems of American education is you have a lot of people in college who have no interest in what a college is supposed to be, nor is there any reason why they should.
You've got all these people just trying to get into college for the sake of it, that you now have a bunch of worthless majors being created to cater to these people and degrees that'll land you nowhere. And it's catering to the worst kind of student, the one who really shouldn't be here. You're not here to just start wasting money and getting drunk off your ass. You're here to get yourself educated. But at this point, I really think universities are intellectual dead zones. It's dead amongst most professors and it's dead amongst most students. The people who are really trying to achieve something here are being screwed over. I think a good way to spot the kids who are taking this more seriously than the others are to look at the kids who take up university jobs. Most of these people worked for the entire school year and on every weekday. I almost always had the same guy making my burrito for me at 8 in the morning. He was always there, working hard and making money, and then he'd go off to class. Now that's someone who gets more respect than the dirtbags back in the dorms, especially since these guys had to deal with the dirtbags as their customers on a daily basis. Hey, what can I get for you?
I'll do like a Big Mouth, and I'll get this meat on it. No, I said this one! This one! God!
This was something I saw one time. Just a douche nozzle.
This one!
So props to all the people who held jobs at the university and had to deal with dirtbag college kids screaming at them on a daily basis. And speaking of screaming, I need to talk about my neighbor. Now from what I can tell, my neighbor was a heavy gamer. It seems like that was all he ever did, because he was always screaming into his microphone in excitement while playing his video games. Except I think he was a little too excited. Here's some of the things that you'd hear him scream.
Oh, fuck my ass, daddy! Why won't you just fuck me?
Daddy, just fuck my ass! Daddy!
Now again, these walls are very thin, so I can hear this all the time.
We're going to fuck! Daddy!
Now I don't think this guy was retarded or anything. He would just say these things. Just scream them out loud, just for the sake of it. Just cause he could. Now he did have a girlfriend, and I know because I could hear her laughing all the time. There was always a... going on from next door. And every time he would scream and rant, she'd be right by his side laughing it up.
Daddy, just fuck my tight asshole!
It's kind of like what you'd see in a meme of some dude screaming, except in real life it's just annoying. But I need you to picture hearing this for hours at a time, every day. And speaking of laughing, as if these guys couldn't get any more douchey, they all had the douchebag laugh.
Stop it!
So I got the girl next door and the guys in the hallways laughing for hours at a time every day. Oh, and I guess I also knew that my neighbor had a girlfriend because I can hear them fucking and sucking every week. And hey, speaking of fucking, let's go back to my roommate. I think the guy had around 5 to 6 different women come around to the room throughout the year. They were all fuck buddies, of course, but before he broke up with, or stopped being fuck buddies with his first girl, they decided they were going to have a whisper argument inside the room while I was in there. And I don't care how quiet you think you are not going to quietly whisper to each other in the middle of an argument. Now, as much as I didn't like this girl because she was pretty trashy, much like all the other girls my roommate brought back, she said something in their little whisper argument that I think says a lot about my roommate.
I feel like I'm being objectified.
Yeah, you probably were, girl. I was about to tell them to go piss off and argue somewhere else when they both finally got up and left. But the argument was just full of a bunch of, I didn't. I'm not. Please, God, kill me. But a few months later, and a few girls later, on Valentine's Day, at 2 in the morning, my dirtbag roommate and his new fuck buddy both decided that it would be a good idea to sneak into our room while I was trying to sleep and start fucking each other. That's right, kids. They started fucking right next to me. And I knew what was going on. So as you might expect, I instantly got up from my bed and yelled at both of them to
get the fuck out!
And they both scampered off half naked. Slut bags. The both of them.
Gouge out my fucking eyes!
So from that night on, I think it's safe to say that my roommate lost whatever respect he had left. Fuck you, roommate. Oh, and I'm just gonna say this about some of you ladies out there. If your idea of fashion and class is to dress like this on a daily basis, with half your ass hanging out and your chest about ready to pop and hanging on by a string, I can't say that I want all that much to do with you. I thought the idea was that you didn't want to look like a prostitute.
We're dealing with sluts today. It's about sluts. We have some sluts. Are you guys dressed like sluts today?
I think that's the definition of
sluts. Ooh. That's a slut look.
You think it's a slut? You think we're dressed like
sluts? That's a slut look.
The way you dress says a lot about you. That's all I'm gonna say.
Amazing. We gotta find some more sluts. Are there any sluts around here?
But I can't even say that the university doesn't encourage this kind of behavior when they literally hand out free condoms in the bathrooms. We had a couple refill piles in our bathrooms throughout the entire school year. The school is encouraging sex.
But at least it's safe sex, Juice Boy.
Hey, that's great. They're still encouraging people to do it. People react to things. You start throwing condoms at them, they're going to use them. But of course, because they left them in the bathrooms, the dorm people decided to start throwing the condoms around all over the place. And would even leave them open on the sink at times. Hey, there's that Milano cookie package I showed earlier. Yeah, there were some open condoms right next to it. No big deal. Hey, there's even one in the sink over there. And here we have condoms and potato chips all over the bathroom. Very nice. And I'm not making this up. The university admits that they're handing out a bunch of free condoms. They are helping to facilitate sexual behavior. I'd say they're also helping to facilitate college drinking parties as well, because they're also selling the plastic red cups in their local stores. You know damn well these are the only types of cups you see at a college party. I'm sure they were making good money off of this. But I can't really blame the college for doing this one. If you're gonna drink and party, you may as well get the cups from us. and then you can trash them on us. And speaking of trash, here's what someone did to their door. As you can see, we have a bunch of memes here. We have Days Since Last Nut, we have the No Nut November meme, that's a classic, and we also have a bunch of dicks. That's nice. But at one point, this door also had a weird white stain on it. Right there. Now, I don't know what this is, and I probably don't want to know, but it just goes to show you how disgusting these people are. Don't touch the walls or doors around here, folks. My own wall even had a faint yellow stain on it. I don't know what the hell it was. Make sure you wipe down your walls when you move into your dorm, people. Everything is disgusting. Even the lounge furniture is disgusting. I'm not sure what era these couches are from, but oh my god, you can just smell the history they've seen. Do not sit on the lounge furniture, especially in Bean Hall. You'll sit on a couch, and 3 seconds later, you'll start to smell the faint stench of 40-year-old sweat, vomit, grease, and possibly cat urine. It's disgusting. And I can't say that these nerds here didn't help contribute to the furniture stench when they're sticking their bare feet on it. Look at that foot. Now imagine the stench of it. Don't sit on the furniture here. Even the recreation furniture sucked. This pool table had no billiard balls or cues. Piece of shit. Even when sitting on regular classroom furniture, you'll start to get a faint stench of something awful. And I can't say that people putting their stinking shoes on the chairs helps at all. This one classroom in particular, everyone was sticking their feet on the backs of these seats. And you wonder why the fabrics are peeling off the backs of each and every one of these chairs. Look at that one. God. Clubhouse dance party. Yeah, that's a good way to describe what colleges are now. This one class in particular, I don't know why even half of these kids bothered to come to class. These two girls here were always on their laptops, and always, I mean always, shopping for bras. The brightness on their computer screens, in this partially lit room, was so unbelievably bright that anyone sitting behind them could see all the bras they were shopping for. Daily. Oh, and look at that foot ripping up the furniture. Nice. This guy in the front here came to class every day, and not once did he ever take notes or take his eyes off his computer screen, where it seems like he was doing some kind of coding? Programming? You can clearly tell it looks different than most word processing software. I think he's coding something. No clue why he showed up. It wasn't even mandatory to attend this class. I don't know why these people came.
Yo, are the lectures gonna be online?
Yeah, they'll be online.
Sweet.
Oh, and this is another point I need to make. Can you people please start to become more self-aware of what you're doing when you're in public? Like, everyone sitting around me in class was being blinded by the light of these two computers. I could see people sitting close by to these two chicks, squinting their eyes and putting their hand up because I swear they had their brightness up all the way. Why do some people put their brightness up all the way to the maximum level in a dark room? How does that not damage your eyes? When I rode the bus in high school, it was pitch black in the mornings at times, but you could still see someone with their brightness all the way up to the maximum level and just burning their eyeballs. I don't understand how some people can do this. Or besides the lighting on your iPhone, how about turning down the volume on your phone so no one else around you has to hear some stupid shit your friend did on Snapchat while you laugh out loud right in front of me? Ladies, I don't need to hear you laughing out loud, nor do I need to hear the clip about how your friend thinks she's fucking hilarious while I'm eating my burrito. Turn down your volume. But anyways, this class in particular was also a major source of stress to the professor, because no one participated in anything, because no one knew anything. Hell, even I didn't know half the shit he was talking about sometimes. So I can't really say it was the most well-taught class. But at one point, the professor just gave up on us and sat down on the floor behind the podium, and stayed there for about 2 minutes contemplating the state of his life. That's the top of his head there. He wasn't very happy. Meanwhile, back on the East Coast... Oh, and of course the Fortnite craze was alive and well in the dorms. Everyone's playing Fortnite.
Wanna play some Fortnite? You down for some Fortnite, man?
Before that, it was Call of Duty World War II. And when that game came out, some guy my roommate knew kept coming to our room so he could hop on his PlayStation. He liked screaming at his teammates a lot.
Oh, come on, teammate. Why do you gotta suck so much dick?
And I didn't get any recordings of some of the other things he'd say, but one of his go-to insults towards his teammates was to call them all blind-ass, Helen Keller-ass Negroes. Or, you're all a bunch of Helen Keller-ass bitches. And if it wasn't him coming over to the room, it was a bunch of other dirtbag friends of my roommate coming over and sitting around all over my bed. So when I'd come back to my room, I'd see the sheets on my bed looking like a mess. I made sure my roommate fixed it up every time I came back. Alright, I don't think there's much else for me to cover about the dorms. I think that's about it. Overall, I think it was a pretty good look into how most people my age really don't know how to take care of themselves at all. And how many are also horribly disciplined, like to trash places, and are borderline criminals. At least two of the people in my hallway have been to juvie before. Yeah. And while most of this might have seemed disgusting, I can't say that I didn't expect it. You can only see so many TV shows and movies and commercials of what your average college is like, and get a pretty good sense of how it's gonna be. None of this was really shocking to me. It was all just expected. I can't say that I really expect much more than this from a bunch of sweaty dudes in their late teens living on their own for the first time. I expected it to be a pretty sick experience. It wouldn't surprise me if I caught some sort of disease from the time I spent here. But this is also a good reason as to why I think the notion of free college is horseshit. You had best believe that I don't want anyone's tax money going to kids like this, who couldn't give two shits about actually learning something, and are just here to party and indulge themselves. If college is already a waste of time and money for so many millions of people, imagine how much more of a waste it'll be of trillions of taxpayer money. Yeah, no thanks. American education is in serious need of reform. Betsy DeVos should immediately dismantle the Department of Education. Immediately. But hey, if after all this, you still don't believe my stories or photos I've taken, here's an audio clip of our residence hall manager scolding us because he would constantly get reports of all the shit that goes on in our building.
Biohazard waste. You all will get charged for it unless someone cleans it up. The second thing. So over the last term, I've been getting a lot of reports about people smoking on the Wilcox second floor, right? I'm aware that on the opposite side of us, y'all are smoking in the stairwell. I'm aware
we're drinking
in the stairwell. Give me 1 second. I'll bring the walkie-talkie down to you in a moment. Right? I'm aware that y'all are drinking and smoking in the stairwell. Cut it. We got 3 weeks left. 3 weeks left. I don't want any more reports about it. And the ones that are doing it, I see some of you all have smirks on your face. Right, y'all need to get each other in check. Right, talk to your friends. I will be around here doing rounds periodically during the day and at night. I hope not to find any of you all. Right, y'all are causing concerns and issues for main housing. You're causing concerns for facilities. It's all coming back to me. Your parents are calling. You got 3 weeks left. I don't want to hear about it anymore. Is that clear?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes. It's true.
There's about 20 of us here. About 6 of you responded. Is that clear?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
Thank you.
Now, if you heard that little bit in the beginning about the biohazard waste.
Biohazard waste.
Before I started recording, he was yelling at us because someone in the hallway decided that it would be a good idea to put a condom on the light switch. So he was pointing at the light switch and saying to us, "Why is there a condom on the light switch?" And then he started talking about how it was a biohazard waste and that we'd all get charged for it if we didn't clean it up. That's why everyone was smirking.
Yeah, I see some of you all have smirks on your face.
Okay, I'm done with the dorms for now. Fuck the dorms and fuck the dorm people. So now let's talk about the campus. Aside from the shitty dorm people, the campus is actually very nice. I don't really have any complaints about it. If you love the geography, you'll love the look of the campus. It's very green here in Eugene, Oregon, of course. In the summer and fall, you'll find a lot of people just laying around on the grass. Good old hippie town. Sometimes I'd walk around at night when it's nice and warm out, just for the sake of it. It's a nice campus. Oh, but don't go to Hilliard Street at night. Do not go there. You will be robbed, raped, sexually harassed, everything. Just 2 streets down from campus is a major crime hole. I got multiple emails throughout the school year about students being assaulted late at night there. Stay away from Hilliard Street. The food on campus was also fine. As I said before, we've got a large Asian community on campus, so we have a nice variety of food. No complaints. With me, if I'm being fed, I'm happy. And as you might already know, we've got spam here. Oh, but don't worry, I know the question you're all asking. Juice Boy, where is the best place on campus to poop? I'm glad you asked. Well, clearly your hallway isn't the best place, but I've been around all these buildings, and I've come down to my top three spots to take a dump. Number three is the library. The toilets here aren't so bad, and it's probably the bare minimum for cleanliness standards. Number two is the Global Scholars Hall lounge toilets. There's just two of them, one on the first floor and one on the second floor. They're both good, and they're just single private rooms that are always kept clean. So go there for clean pooping. The only downside is that it's pretty far away from most of the classes you'll have. But number one is the EMU. On the second floor is probably my favorite bathroom on the entire campus. It is clean, it is regularly cleaned, it does not smell, it's a favorite. Now the only downside with the EMU bathrooms are those damn toilet sensors. I don't know about you, but I freaking hate toilet sensors. I take long dumps, and the last thing I need is for the toilet sensor to randomly trigger and flush the toilet while I'm still sitting on it so it can get my butt all wet with shit water. Now if you're being plagued by toilet sensors like I am, I do have a workaround for you. All you need to do is shove a piece of toilet paper inside of the metal sensor mount to cover up the sensor, and you're good to go. I have yet to encounter any problems while using this tactic. You're welcome. Now on to the professors. I think most of you might have expected this video to have been more about campus free speech control and crazy leftists and whatnot, but honestly, that gets covered so much in right-wing media that I didn't really want to talk about it that much. It's not anything you haven't heard of before. Yes, there are communist professors here. I had at least one confirmed communist professor my fall term. Yes, it's embarrassing, but what are you gonna do about it? It's Oregon. Eugene, Oregon. Now, most Oregonians aren't bad people, nor are they all communists. There's just dirtbags, liberals, and homeless people around town. And the dirtbags are mainly centered on campus, and maybe around the downtown area, and some of the trashier parts around town. And they're not all that politically active, just trashy. But most of the other straight-up liberal folks around here are very nice people, as long as you're not talking about politics. If you go out into the countryside, I'm sure you'll find some more Republican-leaning people, and I'm sure they're fine too. I mostly blame the city politicians for the problems that Eugene, Oregon has, and the way that they manipulate the voting base into thinking in certain ways, thereby allowing them the popularity to enact certain policies. Bullshit policies. My grandpa was telling me a story once about how he was trying to get a road built to his new house, but the city council wouldn't let him build that road unless he specifically paid for and planted about 20 trees along the roadway. And my grandpa kept telling them, "Okay, fine, I'll plant your damn trees, but there's no way you can fit 20 trees on this road. You can only fit like 12 at the most. What are you guys talking about? You plant those 20 trees or you don't get your road." And after a while, because he had to get that road built to his house, he had to do what the city wanted and bought 20 trees for the new road. And just like he told them, you could not fit 20 trees on this road. And he expected the city to repay him for the 8 extra trees, and the city just said, "Nope, no refund." So yeah, screw city planners and politicians. But the town itself isn't some kind of communist Oregon. There's just a lot of liberal tendencies mixed with the need to keep Eugene weird. Which, the way they go about doing that isn't very smart, but I'll get into that later. Back to the actual communists. Now, your professors won't just tell you that they're communists, unless they're completely full of themselves and their self-congratulating virtue, but some of my professors didn't really make any attempt to hide it either. Just do a Google search of your professor, and you'll probably come across their Facebook page, where they say something stupid about themselves like, "Proud and exalted communist." One of my professors had something similar to this on their profile. My writing professor made us all go out and get this compilation book of various speeches and articles, and it seemed like a little under half of them were written by actual communists. He made us read some Angela Davis, communist, there was some Sylvia Federici in this book, communist, and some Larry Kramer and his ranting on how Ronald Reagan is so much worse than Hitler. Hitler! And of course we had to write essays using sources from this handbook. And you're not going to write anything other than something supporting the prevailing leftist vision of the world, because I'm not going to risk my grade here. But let's just say that with the amount of politics I engage in on a daily basis, it wasn't that hard to come up with something to write about. Just talk about oppression and the interconnected, intersectional white power dominion over minorities, and you'll get an A. I got an A. It was funny too, because when I had a meeting with this professor about the rough draft on my essay, he told me that he really, really loved my writings on the interconnected struggles. He just loved it. Bullshitting my way out of that class. This is also the type of professor who'll start making convoluted web drawings on chalkboards, trying to connect all sorts of wild themes and emotions and patterns and all that.
The interconnected nature of Angela Davis's writings on women and the struggle of interracial mixed werewolf people is how we get the unified movement of solidarity amongst the oppressed classes of America. And this all translates back to the grasp of power that the white people hold onto and how whiteness is really the force to unify the struggle around. Yeah.
Just a bunch of postmodernist nonsense. I thought that class would never end. But this is something that I've always been doing ever since middle school. In middle school, I would notice certain speech patterns and words that my teachers would like to use and created an importance around. So I would always cater my work to fit whatever worldview they seemed to have. Now in high school, this worldview became more political, so it became even easier to cater to my teachers because I started to get very politically informed halfway through middle school. So I knew better ways to cater to them. My teacher in AP US History would always get his ruler out and start smacking a picture of George W. Bush, which it doesn't get more obvious than that. So occasionally in some of my work for his class, I'd slide in some random statement on the violence and worldwide destruction caused by the executive leader during the early 2000s, and just hint that I was anti-Republican or Bush or whatever. Or say something about the war on terrorism and how it's actually just a giant military complex push for more evil military control of the oil, and how Bush was just too naive to see all the Hitlerian chaos he was causing. Or something. And what do you know, my papers would always come back with an A. One time on a quiz, this same teacher told us to write about a case of distortion that has occurred amongst a recent political leader. And I was thinking to myself, what the hell kind of question is this? This is just blatant politicization. Well, I guess he wants me to talk trash about Bush. Okay. And when I got the paper back, there was a nice big smiley face next to my Bush statements. Again, American education is a joke. I can always tell the politics of my teachers and professors, and easily cater to their beliefs. Professor said something about banning guns? That's it. Throw some Marco Rubio hate into the writing. What's that? Did you just propagate the trickle-down myth? Okay, time to start trashing Reagan, I guess. If teachers and professors would just shut their mouths more often and be less politically charged in their teachings, we might actually be getting somewhere with any sort of education. But no, most teachers cannot help themselves. They have to get political. So that just means more A's for me. It's especially good if you can throw in some really obscure facts that most of your classmates probably don't know about. I read a lot and spend my time engaging in the political world and history, so I can just start spouting off on a lot of random philosophical points that my professors just eat up. Oh, he knows that obscure quote from Karl Marx's Das Kapital, Volume 3, page 64? Well then, let me just put a nice big A on his paper. So yeah, you want an A? Cater to your professors. If they self-identify as communists, it only gets easier. And remember, always write about evil white people. These people are 21st century neo-racists. Oh, and because this is Oregon, you'll see a couple protests. We had some pro-Palestine demonstrations, the walkout protest for Parkland, and surprisingly, there was a pro-life protest as well. This is the only photo I have of it. As you can see, the pro-life demonstrators held up giant signs with images comparing, this to this. I'm not going to say that word because when I uploaded the previous video, it got demonetized within a minute of uploading, which makes me think that YouTube's automatic subtitle generator found a word in it that it didn't like, and my guess is that it's this one. So, I'm not going to say that word right now. But the protesters held up ginormous signs of bloody this thing photos, and they were graphic, but also brutally honest, so that's fine by me. And as you can see, we also got some counter-protesters trying to cover it all up. Some hippy-dippy kids brought some giant tarps with them attached to sticks to try and cover up the photos. They weren't completely successful, but they made their presence known. Dirtbags. Censor, block, and ban. This is the motto of the modern progressives. This is not going to get any better in the future. Fortunately, we didn't have any riots this year. Apparently, back in 2010, there was a protest where alcohol-induced ragers took to the streets to start breaking shit and rioting. Now, we did have a protest of the dean this year, though. These nerds got up on stage while the dean was trying to give a speech and started crying about "Nothing about us, without us," and "Take back our campus," and "CEO shill." I'm still not sure what this protest was about, but they got their fists in the air. Solidarity! I haven't seen anything like this yet, but all I can say is that there is not a rape culture on campus. As douchebaggy as it is here, the majority of these fuckboys are not rapists. Now, if you decide that you want to come to this university, you're going to be heavily indoctrinated in your first week here, primarily by going to a bunch of sex ed meetings. At one point, they forced us all to watch this cringy play put on by this group called SWAT. And God, the whole time we're watching this garbage, I'm thinking to myself, who thinks like the people they're depicting? These people literally had to depict a dude bro drugging a woman and having his way with her while she was inebriated, and then bragging to his other dude bro friends about how awesome he was in doing that. Are people so retarded now that they need to be taught not to drug and rape intoxicated women? Are we this stupid? God, if we are, I mean, I already said in the beginning of this video that my faith in the future of humanity is practically gone, so Fuck it. Maybe people really are this stupid. Maybe people really don't know not to drug and rape people. Maybe the majority of people literally need to be told no raping in order for them to finally understand. Oh, and in order to be inclusive of men, they also showed how women can be a little too forceful in their sexual advances as well. If you're a man watching this video and you can't handle a situation where a woman is grinding on you when you don't want her to be grinding on you, you are really something special. Hey, girl, I really don't need the shit particles from your ass grinding all over my clothes. Thanks. What are you, a fucking nerd? Oh, and this next one was just great. In your first week here, you will be required to say what your preferred pronoun is on campus. Yes, you heard that right.
Hi, my name is Michaela. I'm from Salem, Oregon. My pronouns are she, her, and hers.
Hey, my name's David. I'm from Wyoming. My major is cinema studies, and my pronouns are he, him, and his.
I'm not doing this! I don't know how many times we had to do this with the ice-breaking introductory sessions, but fuck all of you sensitive little bitches. I am not about to start going around introducing myself by saying, hey, my name is Juice Boy, my pronouns are he, him, and his. Like, what the fuck is this? They are really trying to push this pronoun crap here. I never said my pronouns during these sessions, and I always got looks because I didn't go along with this bullshit. But I just looked right back at them. Fuck your pronouns bullshit. I am not doing this. But I know that the majority of the people here don't want to say that shit either. If you're in a room of 20 people, and maybe the first 2 or 3 people say their pronouns, and then you just say fuck that and don't even bother to say your pronouns, you will start a chain reaction around the room where no one else will say their pronouns, because no one is really that stupid. I have seen this happen 3 times. But if you try to break the chain by the 5th person, it'll be too late. The room will all have been expected by that point to say their pronouns. And do you know how many times out of the maybe 100 total introductory sessions someone said anything other than he or her? Just 2. Only 2 people in all of these stupid pronoun introductions ever said something different. One person said they were a they, and the other just said cisgender, which isn't that just what? But whatever. If they try to pull this crap on me again as I start up sophomore year, I'm still not going to go along with this bullshit, and neither should you. Straight up pronoun indoctrination. This country is so screwed. What the hell happened? But anyways, in your first week here, you're also going to hear a lot of people say this.
I'm from the Bay.
The Bay.
Bay Area.
The Bay.
The Bay.
The Bay.
The Bay.
The Bay.
The Bay.
A lot of the Oregonians that I've talked to say that the majority of problems they have in Oregon are in large part a result of all the Californians moving over. So maybe the real problem here is just with all the Californians. Now I'll get back to campus in a second. But first, I need to talk about another problem Eugene, Oregon has, and that's the homeless problem. Now again, I do not hate people, and that includes homeless people, because it's such a popular saying by leftists that right-wingers just hate homeless people! God damn it, they just hate them all! All they do is hate! But my god, I have never seen more homeless people in my entire life than in Eugene, Oregon. And I know LA is supposed to be 50 times worse, so I don't even want to picture what that looks like. You cannot go anywhere in this town without seeing a homeless dude somewhere. They're all over the place. When I talked to my grandparents, they just said that the homeless people flock to Eugene because they know that people will give them stuff here. And that may be true. I don't know. What I do know is that there are many businesses downtown that have had to keep their front doors locked because many homeless people will just walk in and literally just start sleeping on the floor. Yeah, my grandparents' financial manager's office has to do this. So every time they visit the building, they have to ring some bell so the door can unlock. The hordes of homeless people in this town is largely the reason why there's hardly any activity going on downtown, other than in a few select places. You don't really want to be exploring downtown by yourself. I can't say that it's the safest place. Every time I go walking out in the city, I'm always prepared to get shanked. You can find a lot of stories online about people being robbed on the streets in this town. I was waiting for the bus to go get a haircut one time, and I see some 10-year-old kid in the tank top just sneaking around a parking lot in the middle of the day on an empty street. I don't know about you, but that kid is either running away from school, is homeless, or is peddling crack cocaine out in the streets. Or all of them. There is something dark about this city, and it's right in the open. But the thing about all these homeless people is, a lot of them, and I mean maybe around 80 to 90% of all the homeless people I have seen in this town, are straight up mentally ill. They should not be on the streets. They should be in a mental facility. They cannot take care of themselves. If there's one thing the state of Oregon should be spending taxpayer money on, it's building mental facilities. More than half of the homeless people I've ever seen cannot walk straight. They're always limping around town, and more than half of them are just mumbling random things to themselves and aimlessly wandering around in the city. One time I was waiting for the bus when this old homeless woman was walking in the middle of the street and screaming to herself, "Fuck, fuck, 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 fuck," and then she wandered off into this alleyway. This other time, I was walking to class on campus when some homeless dude on a bike started circling around me and incoherently telling me about some bizarre situation he got into a while ago. And all he was saying was,
"I just wanted one little bit, man. Just one little writ. And she said, no. Ha! You are under arrest. Ha! Just one little writ."
And then he just cycled away. And you know he was a homeless dude because of all the baggage he carried with him. This is a different homeless biker, but on campus, there seems to always be this one homeless guy who parks his bike in the same exact spot every day. And I think this is a photo of the guy. But one of the signs he carries says this, "Trust Jesus now!" And, "All we need is love and $1 million each." Now, the $1 million each part is because I'm pretty sure he has a homeless wife with him somewhere. I know this is a fact because a month before school started, I saw the same exact homeless man and his wife and their two bicycles with the same exact signs at a ZZ Top and Blues Brothers concert. But this dude is always hanging around campus somewhere. You will see his bicycle around. And I don't think the homeless problem has helped any with Oregon's new 10-cent recycled bottle policy. This policy is inadvertently helping to fuel the homeless economy. Damn near every single day, at all hours, there is a homeless person digging through our trash looking to scrounge up anything in our dorm garbage. Oh my god, this is absolutely disgusting. You have no idea the shit we put in these garbage bags, and here we've got a bunch of homeless dudes digging around in this shit. There is a reason why homeless people are generally riddled with diseases. Imagine all of the bloody maxi pads thrown in there, and all the jizz rags, and all the various unknown liquids they're sifting through, and I have so much footage of homeless people digging around in our trash. This was the view from the dorm window. This is what I got to see every day for the last year. Looks like there's someone inside that trash can. Hey, looks like these two brought their dogs with them. And off they go. Here's a late night dumpster diver. This guy looks like a college student, but you never know now. I saw an old homeless woman once who was wearing clothes that looked like it was supposed to be on a 6-year-old child. It was disturbing. Most homeless people I've seen though tend to have dogs with them, which, hey, that's great, you have company. But how much is that dog being fed? What is it being fed? I'm not even sure that it's in the dog's best interest to be hanging around with its homeless owner. More late night dumpster divers. I think this might be the same couple from before wearing the pajamas. Looks like she's got her homeless boyfriend going inside the dumpster. Bye! And most people just walk on by. Just let the homeless do their digging. What are you gonna do about it? Bye! Enjoy your 10 cents! You never know what you'll find outside your window. I was on the bus one time and I was sitting in front of some guy that looked completely out of it. Looked homeless, smelled homeless, and is either mentally ill or was on some sort of high. Every time I went downtown, I'd always get to see the variety of homeless people we have around here. These people are not living in good conditions, and most of them need to be in a mental facility. After I got my hair cut one time, I was waiting for the bus when this homeless guy came running after the bus that just took off. He was completely out of breath and just started screaming, you bitch, I wanted to ride that, you stupid bitch!" And then he sat down next to me and proceeded to start coughing his guts out for the next 5 minutes, until the next bus came. And I'm telling you, for 5 whole minutes, all you could hear was, God. Once the bus came, I looked at the spot where he was spitting, and oh my god, there were damn near 30 phlegm spots on the ground. Just look at this video I took, and now imagine 30 more spots just like it. Unbelievable. Get these people in a mental house. Seriously. This is the one thing your state government can do. The one thing. But one of the biggest hurdles to fixing up these streets and clamping down on all the crime and homelessness around here is the attitude that some people have in Eugene, Oregon. See, to some, if the homeless people aren't directly in their face, it's no problem to them. And for other people, the grime of the homelessness and crime-riddled conditions of downtown is precisely what makes Eugene, Oregon so special to them. It's precisely what keeps Eugene weird. And in no way better is this explained than by the owner of the famous Voodoo Donuts.
This is like pretty much the geographical center of town almost. This has traditionally been a place where homeless people, I mean, forever. I mean, like any major metropolitan city, this is a dirty, grimy part of town, and I love it. I don't want to clean this up at all.
Yeah.
And people are constantly, just like they do in America, gentrifying and making things nicer and neater and cleaner. But this is kind of a cool little bastion of sleaze still, yeah. You know?
But it's clean sleaze though.
Okay, yeah. Let's just keep this place a crime-riddled shithole because you just really like the grime and sleaze of it all. Yeah, let's make businesses fearful that some homeless dude is gonna waltz on into their store and call the place his home, and have a bunch of criminals roam around the streets, because that's what keeps Eugene unique and cool. That's what helps to keep the sleaze of it all. Eugene, get rid of this attitude right now. This attitude is helping to get moronic laws passed, and it's contributing to all the various issues plaguing this town. You want your streets to be clean and safe. You don't want the attitude of this hippie moron because he fears gentrification. Bitch, please. As Kennedy Montgomery says about Portland, keep Portland weird, not stupid. Same thing applies to Eugene. Keep Eugene weird, not stupid. Oh, and apparently it's an argument being made these days that why not leave the homeless people alone? They're living in true freedom. They're living in independence. Living in your own shit and piss is not any kind of exalting freedom. Living day by day, digging in dumpsters for bottles to recycle is not any kind of grand independence. That's about it with the thoughts on the homelessness here. This issue is never going to go away for this town unless there is a serious change in attitude. And speaking of attitude, let's go back to stupid college kids and their wishful thinking. After reading some of the comments from my trickle-down video, I realized just how much people know absolutely nothing about basic economics. I told you all to go out and get this book. Read this damn book! And then I remembered that even in my own high school, a single course on economics wasn't even a requirement until my own class began freshman year. So even my older sister before me was never required to take a course on economics. That's why she knows nothing. Even in college, you're not required to take a course in economics. At least not here. So it's no surprise that some people in these comment sections will literally say, "No, you're wrong. Fuck you," towards basic economic facts. Most people really don't like to live in reality, and would much rather prefer the bullshit spewed out the mouths of politicians and talk show hosts. Economists don't tell you that you can have anything you want in the world. In fact, they tell you the opposite. That's why they're not as popular as politicians, who say they can give you the whole world. So it doesn't surprise me in the least to hear college students complaining about rising tuition costs, while at the same time they're praising all of the new buildings and construction projects the university is working on. You know what's going on right in front of your face every single day on this campus? Construction. Always more construction. When's the last time a federal subsidy or grant ever went towards reducing tuition costs? Never. Oh, but that's what they keep telling me they're for, but it never happens. This is a federally funded institution. The idea of that is supposed to be that the more federal funding the university gets, the cheaper tuition is supposed to be. Bullshit. You know damn well what the administration does with all that money, and that is never-ending construction. I've been walking around this campus ever since I was 5 years old, and every single time I come by here, there is always construction going on and infrastructure enhancements. Well, shit! All that money that's supposed to go to us to make tuition cheaper just goes straight into these construction projects. But because technically the students do end up using these facilities, the money is technically going to us. Bullshit! The only reason for the constant construction around campus is so the university can keep getting more money, and they'll spend any bit of it they can on whatever they deem necessary so that taxpayer dough can keep on rolling in. Hell, we're in the middle of building a brand new research facility right now. And on top of that, we're in the middle of building Tykeson Hall. I walk by this construction every day. And on top of that, we're going to be remodeling our track field with a sleek new metal design. And that's not even the bulk of it. Here's a list of all the capital projects the university is currently working on. All of this stuff. And you wonder why tuition keeps getting more and more expensive. Do you realize all of the maintenance and upkeep that is going to be required after constructing all of these new buildings? And I swear, they have been deliberately building this campus in the most inefficient and cost-ineffective way possible. For about 6 months now, they have been digging a hole in the basketball court here, and no one really knew what the hell was going on. Well, one day, I overhear two officials from the administration walking by and saying to each other,
"Oh, what's all this construction?"
"Oh, that's actually construction for Hayward Field. There's a water line down there that they need to connect with for the track."
"Oh, wow."
Here's the hole they were digging for our track, which is all the way over here. I don't know about you, but does that seem like the most efficient and future-proofing place to lay down a water line that you have to get to connect with for the track field? And this isn't the only random construction you'd find all over campus. Here's some random hole a guy's filling up. Not sure what's going on here. Here's some more construction going on so that the university could put in some weird art project the person made. These gray blocks were placed all around this circle here. They spent money putting these things in here. Is this seriously the most efficient use of the university's money? Early in the school year, the administration sent out an email to all students saying, "Hey everybody, good news! We're only going to raise tuition next year by just 2.8%! This is a great achievement for the university. We're so proud! It was going to be a 10% increase, but we decided to make it 2.8. Gosh, we feel so good about ourselves!" Hey, that's great. And our division of student life is absolutely worthless and helps contribute to the coddling and financial irresponsibility on college campuses. Here's some of the stuff they're funding. Cooking for one or two. Puppies! Don't touch my hair. Funded by the UO Division of Equity and Inclusion. Oh, and here's one of my personal favorites. Sex Cafe, where you can talk about your non-binary, female-identifying, sex-positive experiences. From the Division of Student Life, Services, and the University Health Center. And here's another thing that apparently happened. Laugh really hard and then sigh deeply in the EMU. Sign me up! Hope you're happy to know that this is what you're paying for, Oregon taxpayers. Sex Cafe. But you better not complain about any of this, or you're just refusing basic human rights to gender non-fluid transfunctozoidbergs! And you're probably just one of those racist, goddamn, Trump-supporting, sexist, Islamophobic, homophobic, transphobic, xenophobic motherfuckers! Oh, but we just love everyone! We're so inclusive! Can't you feel our love? Motherfucker! This constant spending by the university on constructing and funding all this crap goes more to the point of what happens when you run a college that's non-profit. There is no incentive to restrain yourself from spending on whatever you want, whereas a for-profit business would be more conscious of all these costs, including what they offer in terms of an actual education. If your university is for-profit, they're probably not going to be offering a whole lot of courses on philosophy or the history of transsexual queers in cinema, because no one in the marketplace is demanding people who are knowledgeable on that crap. If you think you're going to get a job in underwater basket weaving, think again. But the university can tap into whatever endowments or taxpayer money they want in order to provide this crap. And politicians serve it up to their voting base and get them to think that everything going on here is just fine. Yeah. World-class education here. World-class community of students. And aside from just useless classes, because most universities are non-profit and government-funded, they don't compete or operate in the same way as a profit-based institution would. They compete by offering you a bunch of shiny crap that looks cool. Oh, an actual education?
Hey look! We built a new track! With a nice squishy chairs and a sleek metal design!
They're selling you on the amenities, which is basically like what the airline industry was doing before it became privatized. And this is mainly due to accreditation boards, who are looking for these type of amenities when deciding to make your university an accredited institution. And if you're not accredited, then you won't get that juicy financial aid from the government. And these universities can tap into taxpayer money all they want to make these amenities happen. And this is where certain lines can be blurred when a university states something like what the costs of educating students are. But what's considered a cost for the university? Anything they decide they want to spend money on. So that can include overseas campuses, such as one in Rome by the University of Dallas, or they can build overseas student centers in Europe or South America like Stanford does. Or hey, according to The Economist magazine, Ohio University increased tuition by 2% in order to build a student center that contains a 250-seat theater, a food court, and a 5-story atrium. Business Week magazine reported that Princeton built a new residence hall that can fit 500 students, where each room has triple glazed mahogany casement windows made of leaded glass, and the dining hall boasts a 35-foot ceiling gabled in oak, all for a measly $130 million. Or hey, let's start building bowling alleys at the University of Nebraska. Yeah, that goes towards my education. At the Indiana University of Pennsylvania, $270 million were spent on new dormitories, which Becky Sapano of the Chronicle of Higher Education calls swanky. And Eric Hoover says they're much cushier than before. Yeah, I really need that $1,000 desk chair in my dorm room. It's for my education, man. Here's another good one reported from The Economist magazine's article, Just Add Cash. Dallas Morning News reported that Baylor University increased the height of its planned rock climbing wall from 41 feet to 52 feet after learning that Texas A&M University's was 44 feet. Then, the University of Houston built a rock climbing wall that was 53 feet high, and even that was later surpassed by the University of Texas at San Antonio. All of this spending is considered part of the costs of education and can be used to justify increased tuition and getting even more taxpayer money because of rising costs. I'm not sure how I'm learning anything useful by you spending more money on a bowling alley, but sure, go for it. And this is how you know that these institutions are not operating under the same type of constraints that a for-profit institution would run under, and is why there's so much money being thrown at a bunch of pointless amenities. Oh sure, they're nice, but they have nothing to do with my education. Even construction on something that seems like it might have some real purpose might not be of any use to the average student. The same Economist article from 2007 notes that even many undergraduates studying science will have limited access to the benefits of the new campus labs, which are there mostly for the benefit of faculty members and their graduate students. My campus is about to start construction on a new research facility. I highly doubt most of my peers will ever step foot in there. Richard Vedder gives a decent rundown on what it's like when a college is managed as a for-profit business in his book Going Broke by Degree. For-profits operate in modest but comfortable buildings in many locations, rather than in one large centralized campus. Enrollments are measured in the hundreds, or at most, a few thousand on any given campus. And almost all of their facilities are directly related to instruction or administration. There are few, if any, of the recreational facilities, art galleries, concert halls, research laboratories, or libraries that are features of the typical university campus. An education at a for-profit university will also tend to be more focused on getting you practical skills that are valued and demanded in the market, because that's what people are paying for. And because they're not spending shitloads of money on sports arenas and giant research facilities, they're better able to compete with each other based on price. But one of the main reasons why nonprofit universities are protected from having to compete with each other based on price is because of the endless supply of taxpayer money and the standards set by federally recognized accrediting agencies. Many accrediting agencies will require certain amenities to be provided, like a library with over 1,000 physical books, or building some research facility that produces a couple hundred studies a year, in order to be accredited to receive government money and look attractive to students. And these accrediting standards are largely centered around all of the various inputs into a university, rather than the outputs. Tell me, when you were looking for a college, how many times did you see that college advertise their student-to-professor ratio? How many times did you see that college advertise the amount of professors it has, or the amount of grants they receive, or how many foreign students they receive every year, or how high-tech their computer lab is, or how many famous people teach there, or how many minorities they admit every year? When's the last time you heard a report on what the actual quality of the education you're getting is, or the likelihood that you're going to get a job after being educated by a university, or how your university's course on the history of midgets and international shipping compares to the same course taught by the university next door? Whatever measures there are for what the actual quality of your education is, it's all measured by these inputs, rather than what the end result is. And this is problematic because as a consumer who is paying for the services of being educated, you don't have access to the most reliable information. And the information you do have access to isn't being determined by the market so much as it is being determined by the arbitrary standards of accreditation boards and college ranking institutions. Back in 2007, The Economist magazine reported that the London School of Economics, which used to be 17th in the rankings, went all the way down to 59th because it got less credit than in previous years for the impressive number of foreign students it had managed to attract. Okay, make sure you get a lot of foreign students coming to your university now. Shit. And there have only been very few attempts at creating studies that actually measure the quality of education through the outputs that the students receive and their achievements later in life. In 2008, the Center for College Affordability and Productivity attempted to do this, and the results they came up with placed several institutions at a higher ranking than in their conventional positions. Schools like Whitman, Washington and Lee, Barnard, and West Point that didn't even make the US news list of the top 50 colleges ended up being within the top 10 of the Center for College Affordability and Productivity's list, and a bunch of other smaller liberal arts colleges made it higher on the list compared to the US news list.
My own college, which was ranked at 54 by the US News and World Report, ended up being 14th on the CCAP ranking. But because for-profit universities are less likely to have these amenities or focus on student-professor ratios, they're also less likely to be accredited or end up on these college ranking boards. If a for-profit university only uses online books, but an accrediting agency measures the number of physical books in their decision-making, that can screw over your institution, because now you're going to have to spend all that money to find the space to build some sort of library and store a bunch of books that could have easily been found on a computer. Or, if an accrediting agency looks at the student-to-professor ratios, then an institution that has a bunch of graduate students teaching the class while the professor goes off and does research is going to look much better on the statistics, compared to an institution that just has the professor teach a class instead of doing a bunch of research. And because of stuff like this, a university attempting to manage itself in the most cost-efficient way can wind up being unaccredited and removed from college rankings. Here's a good case that happened at the University of Colorado's law school back in 2003. So what some law schools will do is to hire on currently practicing judges or lawyers or attorneys to do some part-time teaching in their respective specialties. And this can be advantageous because, obviously, they're currently in the business of law and are going to be more up-to-date on certain practices and modes of operation. And since they're not full-time faculty, they don't require a massive law building or a bunch of supplies in order to teach. Well, the American Bar Association was having none of this, and they started to threaten the University of Colorado's accreditation. And this was despite the fact that at the time, the graduates of the law school had a 92% passing rate for the bar exam on the first try. This was a rate higher than the national average, and higher than the rates at Harvard and Yale on their first try, according to the Denver Post. This same article notes that the American Bar Association has renewed its concerns over the University of Colorado's inability to construct a new law building in the absence of state funding. The American Bar Association is requiring CU President Betsy Hoffman and upcoming law dean David Geddes to appear before its accreditation committee in January to show why the law school shouldn't be placed on probation or removed from the list of approved law schools. The ABA is also asking CU to explain the lack of minority and female faculty and says it is concerned about the number of courses taught by adjunct professors, which in this case are those judges, lawyers, and attorneys who actually know a thing or two. In addition, CU ranks low for annual expenditures on law library materials. It's $1.7 million less than the average, according to the ABA. So clearly, the American Bar Association has no interest in what the actual end result or the quality of the educational output that the University of Colorado offers their law students is. They're more concerned about all these pointless inputs, which in this case clearly don't have any educational importance. Listen, we get that your law students pass the bar exam 92% of the time on the first try, at a rate that is higher than the national average. But where are all your brown skin people? Vaginas? Hello? And after all this, the University of Colorado ended up having to spend over $40 million to create a new law building, which led to a rise in tuition at the law school from $6,700 to $16,738. Out-of-state residents had to start paying $30,814. The most recent tuition numbers at the law school from 2012 state that in-state tuition residents now pay $31,154, while out-of-state students pay $37,940. Hooray, accreditation boards! According to a paper by the Center for College Affordability and Productivity, the American Bar Association has also specified the number of square feet required for each law professor's office. Yeah, listen, your office, it's not quite big enough. You don't have the right measurements. What the hell are you talking about? It's just fine. What kind of clown show institution are you running here, Dean? In the 1990s, the American Bar Association also tried to dictate what the salaries of law professors should be, before they were assailed by the Justice Department. One president at the University of Florida said that accreditation agencies blackmail us. If they say your Department of Astrophysics needs 12 spaceships and you only have 10, you better get the other two. Just take money from the History Department, because that doesn't have an accrediting lobby to protect it. And another former president at the University of Missouri once said that the American Bar Association insisted that we should have a new building. They didn't care if that's where the university's resources could be best spent. Just get a new building. Even a former accreditor acknowledged that teams of accreditors would come up with random reports in which time and time again, they called for institutions to spend more money.
often for physical facilities, libraries, or faculty. But hardly ever were these recommendations connected to improving the outcomes of the learning experience. We assumed that this result would occur, but never verified that the changes had had this effect. Oh, that's just great. So they never explain how all this extra spending on inputs actually benefits the students. Just keep spending. Great. My own college is accredited by the Northwest Commission on Colleges and Universities, and here are some of their standards. 1. Consistent with its mission, core themes, and characteristics, the institution creates and maintains physical facilities that are accessible, safe, secure, and sufficient in quantity and quality to ensure healthful learning and working environments that support the institution's mission, programs, and services. Sufficient in quantity and quality is the key phrase here. What do those things mean? What metric are they using to determine this? No one knows. 2. Equipment is sufficient in quantity and quality and managed appropriately to support institutional functions and fulfillment of the institution's mission. Who determines what equipment is sufficient in quantity and quality? How do they measure this? No one knows. Now here's a vague one. 3. Consistent with the nature of its educational programs and methods of delivery, the institution creates effective learning environments with appropriate programs and services to support student learning needs. What exactly measures the effectiveness of this learning environment and the appropriateness of the programs and services to support student learning needs? I don't know. They don't tell us here. 4. The institution has appropriate and adequate technology systems and infrastructure to support its management and operational functions, academic programs, and support services, wherever offered and however delivered. Appropriate and adequate. Here's one on the governing board. The institution has a functioning governing board consisting of at least 5 voting members, a majority of whom have no contractual, employment, or financial interest in the institution. Now, in our society, which is constantly demonizing profit, money, and financial interest, this might seem like something good to you. But tell me, when you hire someone on your governing board, someone who has no contractual, employment, or financial interest in the institution, what exactly says that they're going to govern it in the best possible way? There's no investment being made by this board of governors into the university. They seem to have no engagement or knowledge in how the university even runs. What exactly says to you that they're going to run it in the most efficient way? What is it that says to you that these people even know how the university operates on a day-to-day basis? If someone from the science department says, "Listen, guys, we need you to allocate more money to the science department so we can maximize our operational capacity. We're straggling behind here." What exactly is stopping the governing board from listening to their demands? Why would they even care? They don't have a financial interest in the university, and there's no need to investigate this claim or even make a decision that leads to the most efficient possible outcome. They have nothing to lose if they decide to listen to the whims of some random professor. And these are just a few of the accrediting standards that impact how a university's resources are allocated. And because of the prestige of being accredited, if you get a degree from an unaccredited institution, your piece of paper might be completely worthless to a potential employer or other educational institution. And don't start thinking that this is going to get any better if we start to have free tuition Bernie Sanders style. God, can you imagine how much more money would be spent in this country? I mean, that is instant financial bankruptcy. Now there'd really be no incentive to cut back on costs. Government'll pay for it all. But because getting the actual metrics on the success of students after they get their college degrees is difficult, and because those numbers are far from readily available and are out of the reach for most accrediting agencies to even be able to handle, we get standards based on what is easily available and visible to the average person. Okay, we got 30% whites, 25% blacks, 40% Asian, and only 5% Middle Eastern? Yeah, maybe next time, racists. And because accreditation boards are the key to getting government money and subsidies, they have a lot of clout on them. From the academic year of 1963 to 1964, all the way to 2008 to 2009, federal aid has increased more than 60 times. So yeah, there's a lot of money flying around here. Your money. And because they're also not functioning like a for-profit business would, this means that most universities can also set arbitrary admission standards. Which means that if the people in charge of admissions to the university arbitrarily decide that they want to focus on diversity instead of actual grades and test scores, then they can set the bar higher for Asian students across the country. Because if they actually decided these things based on individual merit instead of diversity, then you better believe the majority of colleges in America would have a higher proportion of Asian students attending. Oh, but that won't look good for our diversity quotas. This is what one Asian student was suing Princeton for, claiming that they rejected him based on his Asian national origin. But some universities will be a little sneakier about how they reject Asians, like Harvard, which uses a personality trait test to determine how to judge certain students. And it turns out Harvard has been categorizing Asian students as having lower scores for traits of likability, courage, kindness, and being widely respected, which negatively impacts their applications and levels of acceptance. This is not how a profit-based institution would function at all. A profit-based institution just wants the best student, with the best qualifications. That's it. None of this, "Oh, well, your skin color is black and you're from North Carolina, but we really want this other guy who's got more of a mango-orange skin color and is a Latino student from Guatemala, because diversity is really important to us." But my grades and test scores are objectively better than this other guy. I'm objectively the better student. "Yeah, but you're not mango-orange." Yeah, go fuck yourself! This is what used to happen to Jewish students back in the 1920s and 30s, who far outqualified most non-Jewish individuals, but began to be excluded from universities because, well, we can't just have a bunch of Jews in the university. What about the Asians or the Anglo-Saxons? This was a pretty well-recorded fact with former Harvard president Lawrence Lowell when he ran the place from 1909 to 1933 and started to change the process of admissions at Harvard to not accept students based on academics, but based on potential that would reveal their true character. Well, now it's going on with Asians. And because there are differing and subjective criteria used by every university, it's also partly responsible for why no one who applies to a university is ever completely certain they'll get in. Sure, you have decent grades, but are you exotic enough in your ethnic origin? How do they determine your exclusivity? Are blacks more alluring than Filipinos here? Is being from the countryside better than being from the city? Should I have spent more time volunteering at the local dog pound in middle school? Is my childhood full of enough tragedies for this institution? Should I have demanded my parents send me to vacations all across the world so I can talk about the development of my global and cultural consciousness? Should I have pushed my grandma down the stairs and killed her so I can write about the struggles of being raised without grandparents? Should I have joined my high school social justice book club so I can add virtue signaling to my repertoire? Should I describe to them the struggles of my androgynous sissy boy blizz-gendered systematic oppression by white patriarchs? What the fuck does this college want from me? In 2011, about 70% of the applicants at Amherst who scored between a 750 and 800 on the math SAT were rejected, while 20 students who scored below 550 were admitted. In 2016, 45% of the applicants at Cornell who scored between a 750 and 800 were rejected, while 70 students who scored below 550 were admitted. In Economic Facts and Fallacies, Thomas Sowell writes that at Brown University, even students with a perfect 800 math score were accepted for the class of 2012 only 26% of the time, while more than 24 students with math scores below 500 were accepted. You can find numbers and statistics like this at nearly every institution. Clearly, we are not operating by objective standards. And this is why in 2006, an Asian American student named Jian Li, who had a perfect score on the SATs and was just 10 points shy of perfect on the Physics, Chemistry, and Calculus SAT, was rejected by Stanford, MIT, Princeton, and two other Ivy League institutions while being accepted at Harvard and Yale. And his white classmate, who had lower SAT scores and grades compared to him, was somehow accepted to Princeton. And there's already been plenty of federal investigation into this kind of practice by universities. In the 90s, Harvard was found to be stereotyping Asian Americans as quiet, shy, and oriented towards math and science. The University of California in 1990 was found to be discriminating against Asian American graduate school applicants. And in 1992, Berkeley's law school agreed to end their policy of limiting Asian enrollment by comparing Asian applicants with each other rather than the entire applicant pool. This is why so many Republicans call affirmative action policies and college admission standards blatantly racist and moronic. What is it exactly that makes being born in Mexico better than being born in Canada, or vice versa? What is it about the mango skin people that makes them inherently better than black skin people? You're not judging people as individuals, but based on, literally, whatever the hell you want. Diversity, inclusiveness, increased consciousness, and all that other trivial crap. How about we decide these things based on your academics and not on the exoticness of your skin color and ethnic background? How about that? No, Juice Boy, you just don't get it. We're enlightened by our esoteric standards. So very enlightened. You just don't get it, you fucking racist! And another reason for this type of admission subjectivity is so that they don't look simplistic or crudely formulaic. That's from Tom Parker, Amherst Dean of Admissions and Financial Aid. Here's what Brown University says on their common data set for the 2017-2018 school year. They don't have an admission policy described for all students, they have an admission policy for most students. But our selection process entails a holistic review of an applicant's admission file. We want to see what an applicant has accomplished, as well as evaluate the applicant's potential to thrive within the unique offerings of Brown University. Okay, so now they're evaluating your potential to thrive at their university. Who decides that? By what criteria? You don't know. It's all bullshit. And this whole arbitrary process of admissions is another reason for increasing tuition costs and administrative spending. Because once again, unlike a for-profit university, a non-profit university is not constrained by making decisions in the most cost-efficient way. There is no incentive to reduce the amount of people working within a college admission staff or to run by a set standard when admitting applicants. The admissions process does not reflect the interest of stockholders or shareholders or people who have a stake in the institution to produce the best product, that being an education. The people among the admission staff have their own interests, and they'll spend however much money they have to in order to secure them. This is the reason for why the size of most college admission staff keeps growing. E.J. Kahn notes that after World War II, the admission staff at Harvard consisted only of one admissions officer and a part-time secretary. That was it. Today, you'd be hard-pressed not to find even the smallest college have a dozen or so full-time staff members to manage the new admissions bureaucracy. Why is there a growing admissions bureaucracy? Because colleges have access to all the taxpayer money and government subsidies they want. This means that you can just set a bunch of subjective standards and increase your budget so you can hire a bunch of people to look over applications and sort out all the various paperwork involved. It also opens up the ability for an admissions official to travel all across the country and form relationships with a bunch of high school counselors and students in order to set up showcases for the university and recruit new students, rather than letting the students come in on their own and deciding which one you want based on an objective academic criterion. All of this traveling and maintenance of relations with high schools also means you need to hire more people to deal with those activities and manage the bureaucratic nature of it all. And because of this, it's also a reason to expect higher pay. When you have to manage more and more people, it increases the personal prestige of the person working in the admissions office who has to manage all this crap. So they have every incentive to increase the size of their staff and operations because it gives them a reason to proclaim greater responsibility and get more pay. Even Ohio Wesleyan, which has a very small student population, claims to have thousands of high school counselors with whom we are in some contact. And if you don't believe me on any of this, then believe the former dean of admissions at Stanford University, who said, "If we only admitted students based on SAT scores, I wouldn't have a job." Yeah. Don't think that just because an institution says they're non-profit that they aren't influenced or make decisions based on money. And because many are non-profit, they don't have anyone to be accountable to. Nor do they have anyone monitoring the effects of their decisions. They don't have stockholders that demand statistics or charts or impact reports, and they don't have any constraints on the amount of money they can spend. All this because they've got a government and a bunch of taxpayers that they can rely on. Mix that in with some arbitrary accreditation standards and you're good to go. Just keep on spending and keep on raising tuition. Keep those kids coming, parents. This problem is only going to continue to get worse unless something is done about it. Especially when we have student organizations run by complete morons to help them out. I was in a business class a few months ago when some person from our student government came to our class to talk to us about all the great and wonderful things they can do for us, such as lowering tuition. Hey! We have been working so hard to lower our tuition. That is one of the most important things we can do. Okay, that's fine. And then she started talking about how the student government is also working to secure more money from the university for more student wellness centers. And other fun stuff like street fairs, arts and craft centers for relaxation and stress management, and more mental health centers and more resource facilities for our well-being. I think I was the only person in the room listening to this and thinking to myself, "Woman, are you fucking stupid?
What are you, morons?
We want to lower tuition, but we also want to spend a shit ton of money on all this other stuff. Yay! 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 How in the hell do you expect the economics of this to work out? Where do you think all this money comes from? Well, we secure it from the university. And where do you think the university gets its money from? The government. And where do you think the government gets its money from? Okay, Mithra, I think you're getting a little angry with me now. This is why I don't like a lot of people my age. A lot of them are just full of a bunch of mindless optimism with no sense of rationality. And they just expect these things to work out.
the way they want them to, and to have all these things catered to them with no consequences for their actions. Like, no one has ever told these people to just deal with it, or life ain't fair, and their parents have probably given them everything they could have wanted in life. A lot of these people are just bitches. So many of their parents have absolutely failed to prepare them to use their brains. It's like, free money, dude! Let's go smoke some weed! My friends back home should already know this about me, and I know some of you are watching, but I do not take part in the bullshit that people my age do.
Oh my god, dude, let's like all go over to Alex's house and like smoke a bunch of weed and like get super drunk. Are there any hot bitches coming? Yeah, dude, Jessica, man? Oh, fuck yeah, dude, she's got some nice titties, man. Hey, man, check out her Instagram, bro. Look at her fucking tits, man. Damn, dude, I want to smash that ass. I got her nudes, bro. Airdrop them.
I have always found the culture surrounding me to be so centered on depravity and just doing whatever you can to get the most pleasure and stupidity out of life. I mean, that is seriously what people live for now. Pleasure. That quick fix. How many times can I jerk off in one day to feel some sort of dopamine rush? How many drinks can I shove down my throat before I vomit and we can all film it and put it on Snapchat and have a good laugh? How many sluts can I stick my dick in because my entire existence is centered around the pleasure I get out of sex? How many parties can I go to where I twerk my ass on some random strangers and take them back to my apartment later, just to have a little fuck for the road? I think one of the biggest lies I've ever heard said by people around me, and even by my own mother, is the saying of, you only live once. The implication of that being, do whatever you want that brings you pleasure and happiness. If we're only living for pleasure and that dopamine rush, then what the hell is the point of existence? I mean, what are we doing here? If your sole purpose in life is just pleasure, without any devotion to a higher purpose or meaning in life, what are you doing here? What is your purpose? And honestly, this is what all the nonsense that goes on at college is all about. Just doing stupid shit for the hell of it, for the pleasure of it all, and not thinking through any of the consequences that come with that. This is why I think so many young people are depressed. No one has any meaning in their lives. They're just here to have the most fun possible, and anything that gets in the way of that is something to be avoided and looked down on. They're not trying to do work or create something to achieve a higher purpose. They're just trying to tick that neurotransmitter so they can feel good about themselves. Their entire purpose in life is fucking, partying, and doing absolutely nothing with their entire being. Their job on this planet is pure pleasure. That is not a life to live by. That's straight up depression.
I don't know that there are that many people in the United States who actually see that. I mean, they see there are too many people. Maybe I'm the pessimist here, but I see a lot of people in the United States who see work as something to be avoided. Like they attribute all of their stress to work. Work is always a bad thing. When they talk about things in their life that they want to get over, it's work. And my belief is sort of the belief from the book of Genesis, which is that you are put on the earth to cultivate it. And the minute you stop cultivating it, there's no reason for you to be here anymore.
Where's the meaning? The meaning is in responsibility. You know, because people avoid that's Peter Pan again, avoid responsibility. It's just a burden. It's like, no, it's not. It is a burden, but voluntarily hoisted. It's the place of maximal meaning. And the more responsibility you take, the more meaning you have. And that's the antidote to the catastrophe of life.
This might be one of the biggest bullshit sayings I've ever heard in my life. But probably the most unpopular place to say something like this is at a college campus. So needless to say, I haven't made any friends during my first year here. Largely because most conversation starters at colleges revolve around, do you like drinking? Do you do any drugs? Do you know any horny sluts? Which sororities have the baddest bitches? Do you have the answers to the test? And, oh my god, have you heard Lil Gucci Gangbang's most recent song? I could not care less about any of this crap. And I'm not the type of person that just has to have friends. Oh my god, what am I gonna do without friends? I am very introverted. I did the Myers-Briggs personality type test, and I came out as an INTJ. So a lot of the things that do interest me and get me to start talking don't really have all that much to do with Lil Gucci Gangbang's latest hit. Something more along the lines of an actually meaningful topic will work for me. Actually, when I looked it up, INTJs only seem to account for 2% of the population, so that's probably why I don't get along with 98% of people. Honestly, recording the scripts for these videos is probably the most talking I'll do in a month. The script for this video is nearly 50 pages long, so that's a lot of talking for me to do. But if anything, having to not worry about what I'm gonna do with my friends over the weekend, or who I'm gonna hang with, has freed up a lot of my time to do some more reading, especially since I'm not a fast reader.
But aside from the shitty dorm people, and the political indoctrination at the university, and the mobs of mentally ill homeless people downtown, and the state of universities in America, and the stupidity of our student government and youth culture, Eugene, Oregon, or, well, the whole state of Oregon, and really the Pacific Northwest in general, has probably got the best geography on the entire planet. If I had to pick from anywhere on the planet to retire in, it'd be the Pacific Northwest. The geography of the place is just perfect. And there are many fantastic places that you can go hiking or camping in to get a nice look at the place, especially in Oregon. Crater Lake is just gorgeous. I did my high school environmental science project on this place. I know all about it. But if you ever do go, make sure you hunt some crayfish, because they're apparently making the indigenous Mazama newt go extinct. There's also the Silver Creek Waterfalls, which is just up in the hills of Silverton, Oregon. As the name suggests, there's just a bunch of waterfalls. There's a hiking trail there that you can follow where you can see up to 10 different waterfalls. It's a nice place. Oregon is basically littered with waterfalls. There's a pretty one called Sahale Falls over in the Willamette National Forest. Now, I don't think you're supposed to go where I was filming this footage because, you know, you might fall.
But I was feeling a bit on the edgy side, huh?
Within Eugene, you can go up Spencer's Butte for a nice little hike. You get an excellent view of the valley from up there. There's also a spot back in the mountains called Blue Pool. I think you can see why it has that name. Now, it might look like antifreeze or Windex, but don't be fooled into thinking that. This pool is filled with water that is so damn pure that it turns into this topaz blue. The water comes from underground, so it filters up through the porous lava rock bed down below, making the water virtually free of any sediment or other tiny organisms. And don't be fooled by the perception of the rocks either. It might look like it's only 5 feet deep, but it's probably closer to 30 feet. And you never know, you might just catch a diver.
Oh, he hit his knees.
And finally, there's the Oregon coast. Over at the Heseda Head Lighthouse, you'll get yourself a really nice look at the coast. If you go a little further north, you'll end up in Depot Bay, world's smallest bay, where you can potentially get yourself a glimpse at some of the whales that hang around the kelp beds close to shore. Pretty neat. If you don't see any whales though, you'll probably get yourself a glimpse of the sea lions that like to hang around the docks. Oh, and fun fact, Depot Bay is also the place where they filmed that one scene from One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. There's also a really good place to eat around here called the Sea Hag. Get yourself a bowl of the clam chowder, and don't forget to stop by Ainsley's Saltwater Taffy Shop next door, and get yourself some sweets. Now, this is a pretty recent development for the Oregon coast, but you might want to watch out for great white sharks now. The water up here has been getting a bit warmer these past few years, so there's been some sightings lately. And speaking of sharks, I watched a movie a while back called Mondo Cane, and apparently, the indigenous peoples of the Malaysian archipelago get so pissed off at the sharks there, because they kill and maim so many of the inhabitants of the region, that they'll go out on their boats in full revenge mode and capture a shark just so they can shove a bunch of poisonous sea urchins down its throat and let it loose again. So it goes back into the ocean in pure agony for about a week before it dies. Now that's payback, Malaysian style. But the people who are left maimed by the sharks don't have much else to do other than to farm for sun-dried shark fins along the shore and sell them for what little money they can. That sucks. But this village in particular also buries their dead in the ocean, so there's just a huge pile of bones down beneath them. I don't think that's going to help your shark problem. Now, this documentary is from 1962, so I'm not really sure if they're still up to this hardcore shark beat down today, but I just thought this was pretty interesting. Yeah, you fucked that shark up, fellas. I guess these days we just drag sharks behind speedboats. Huh. Now, aside from certain geographical landmarks, there's a few other places to go within Eugene. There's downtown, which, aside from the homeless that are all over the place, there's a spot called 5th Street where you can do some high-class shopping. There's the Saturday Market on, Saturdays, where you can see a bunch of weird hippie shit and check out the farmer's market and other neat things. Make sure to grab yourself a Rita's Burrito. There's a couple of shops around the Saturday Market area, like the previously mentioned Voodoo Donuts that you can check out. It's interesting, but I'd say that most people from Eugene don't really think it's all that special. It's just a donut shop. But you can grab yourself the acclaimed Cock and Balls Donut while you stop by.
I've never had a dick in my mouth, but you know what I'm saying? There's a first time for everything.
Some better places to check out are Off the Waffle, Sweet Life, and the Cornbread Cafe. They get my approval. Though be wary of the operating hours at Off the Waffle. Again, this is a hippie town, so some businesses don't really like to operate on normal hours. One time we showed up at 2 in the afternoon on a Tuesday, and the place was closed down because the entire staff was out canoeing that day for some sort of spiritual reinvigoration. What the hell? One time we were driving on the highway, and someone was trailing their funeral casket behind them. You never know what you'll find in Eugene, Oregon. And hey, you might even find Sasquatch. Luckily, I got to Eugene back in the beginning of August 2017, before the school year started, which meant I was able to catch a glimpse of last year's solar eclipse. Now, Eugene, Oregon was just barely outside of the full solar eclipse range, so I only got to see a 99% eclipse, and that 1% makes a big difference, but it was still pretty neat. I took these photos through the sun protection glasses, since the camera lens on their own wouldn't have been able to get a good picture. I'd say the most interesting part of an eclipse is always seeing how the animals react. They just know that something ain't right. Next year in January, we're supposed to have a total lunar eclipse go by, so hopefully I'll be able to catch that as well. But that's Oregon for you, for some semblance of positivity in this video. Heading back to the university though, for the last time, finally, after the worst year of my life, we had made it to move out week. We're going home. But even throughout move out week, the dorm people were still just leaving their trash all over the place. Yeah, let me just leave my toothbrush package trash on the counter here, along with the paper towels. Yeah, I'll just leave my tongue scraper and other oral products here. Let the janitors take care of it. You might think someone just left this here because they were going to come back for it, but they didn't. It was just sitting here for over 24 hours on move-out week. The janitors took it away. Oh, and this was just great. Some jackass with a lot of drinks on his hands decided, you know what, I'm going to uncap my drinks and throw them around all over the hallway. Yeah, look at this. There's no cap on that Gatorade, and it's upside down. It's just slowly leaking Gatorade all over the carpet. And unless you have ninja reflexes, you're gonna end up spilling all of it out when you pick it up. This is why the hallway smells like shit. Yeah, let me just leave my two drinks here, pouring out all over the hallway. Yeah, fuck these people. Complete jackasses. And I have reason to suspect that this might have been the doing of my roommate, since he would always stock up on Gatorade and other soft drinks throughout the school year. And he did have a full bag of drinks similar to what was left in the hallway the day he moved out. Dirt bags. Everywhere. I talked earlier about all the crap people bring with them to college, and that really comes to light during move-out week, when you see the piles and piles of trash build up. All this shit. They had to bring out a bunch of extra trash sorters to filter out all the stuff being thrown away, mainly because hardly anyone even bothers to sort out their trash between things that get recycled or go into the regular trash, and people keep putting things where they don't belong. Oh, but this next part was both one of the most funny and pathetic things I have ever seen. So apparently, this whole time, there was some kind of rabid anime hentai weeb living in the dorms with us. Because I walk into the bathroom one day during move-out week, and find that someone left this on the counter. Yeah, a hentai toy. Some sick bastard in the dorms here bought himself a hentai toy, and decided he was going to leave the box in the bathroom here. Oh, he took the toy alright. You can't forget the toy. But the box? Yeah, I'll just leave it here for the rest of the dorm people. Have fun with your Ayaka Futaba, you goddamn weeb.
Honto ni kawaii ne!
Mohe, mohe, mohe.
Disgusting. Even more absurd was that right around this corner here in the trash section was a mountain of anime toys. Look at this shit. Some fucking weeb was keeping all this shit in his room the entire time. I don't even know how they had the room to keep all this with them. These rooms aren't that big. This is way too much. And I swear it must be the same person who owned the hentai toy. It must be. Just a mountain of this shit. Who buys this garbage? Matsuda Kanan?
Sugoi ne!
Sonoda Umi?
Hey,
kawaii!
Kawaii! Kawaii! Kawaii!
Unbelievable. This hentai anime culture is another thing that's got to stop. It's turning people into disgusting weebs. Weebs!
Come on. Oh, come on. Oh, come. Oh. Oh, 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 come on.
You know there's a group of men in Japan who are so embarrassed with themselves that they stay locked up in their rooms for years at a time, and just spend their days reading manga and watching anime? This group of people are called hikikomori. They're essentially a bunch of reclusive men who have completely given up on themselves and the rest of society, and stay locked up in their rooms for years at a time, only coming out at night if they have to. There have been cases of people staying locked up for over 10 years. These are first world problems, man. I can't wait for what the future holds. Myself being half Japanese, watching this video was slightly disturbing for me, because I can somewhat understand these guys, on a cultural level. Like, I can understand how certain Japanese societal norms could have brought these people to hide away in their homes for their entire lives. I was born in Japan, and lived there for probably about 3 or 4 years in total when I was around the ages of 2 to 5. So I actually went to a Japanese Shinto Buddhist school for a little while when I was younger, and I was ensconced in the culture enough for it to have an impact on me. Japanese was actually my first language. And fun fact, I wasn't able to speak to my white male colonialist patriarch American father until I was about 5 years old. I remember when I was younger just looking up at him in frustration because I didn't know the English to speak to him with. Only Japanese. And I don't know how much of it I can attribute to the Japanese culture or to my own familial upbringing, but there may be a reason as to why I can't stand dorm people in the obnoxious screaming and hyper-emotional dirtbag culture that pervades both younger and pop-cultural society. And that might have to do with this notion in Japan of, hey, stop bothering people, don't make a scene, shut up, be considerate of other people, no one cares about your opinion. But unlike most hafus, I really don't like the anime scene all that much. I've never really been a fan of the art style and the weird childlike voice acting and hyper-emotional speech patterns that anime is riddled with. It's all weird and is not reflective of actual human behavior.
Look at this. What's this? What's that hand behind the head gesture? That's what anime characters do. They do that all the time.
Yeah, I'm not a fan. But remember, you can still like it even though I'm trashing on it. Oh, but don't be an anime otaku. That's looked down upon in Japan. It's not something to be proud of. So, yeah, we had a weird hentai anime weeb living in the dorms this whole time. We've got to stop the hentai infestation. It's disgusting, but it's also funny.
I'm gonna shoot you right in your fucking hentai.
But aside from all that, in the last 3 days of move-out week, I was finally able to achieve a minimal amount of peace and quiet. Minimal. Oh, and you're supposed to clean your room before you leave and make it look somewhat presentable and vacuum the floor and all that? Well, my roommate also failed to do that, so I vacuumed his shit once he left. Fuck you, roommate. Overall, this experience was pretty terrible. It started out in the middle, but it got a lot worse as the year went by. I guess the only good thing about this past year was the creation of the channel back in October. That's about it, really. There's been permanent damage to my soul. Irreversible damage. I'm all sorts of fucked up now! So I emptied up my room, packed it all up, and I'm not looking back. I wasn't traumatized or anything. I'm just extremely, extremely disappointed. And probably depressed. I was just glad to get the hell out of there. But I'm home now, for a little while longer. I know some of you might already be in college right now, so the timing of this video is kind of off. I originally planned on releasing this in July, but you don't just pump out 2.5 hour long videos overnight. I guess if you start in the last week of September like me, this video is still on time. Sort of. But I'll be heading back soon to start sophomore year, or technically, credit-wise, because of all my high school credits, I've been a sophomore since the beginning of spring term, but I can't say I'm all that excited. I honestly don't foresee myself graduating from this institution, and I don't think any other institution is really going to be all that much better. I'm already looking at just enlisting. If I'm going to spend my time being miserable, then I may as well sign up and embrace the suck. I need something to do. Now, some of you who are a few years younger might be wondering, should I go to college? And honestly, unless you're going to be an engineer, doctor, lawyer, accountant, or something that actually needs a degree, it might not be worth it. If I didn't go to college, then I would have just straight up enlisted in the Navy. And it's looking very likely that that's going to be my future course of action. Don't be surprised if you see a video from me in the future saying, I joined the Navy! But understand that you do not need a college education in order to be successful in life. And there are more than enough examples throughout history to show that. John D. Rockefeller studied bookkeeping for 10 weeks at a commercial college. Billionaire. Henry Ford dropped out of high school and just started working as a mechanic. Billionaire. Your GPA does not define you or the success you will have in life. It's your own level of commitment and willpower. You know what I did with my summa cum laude medal from high school? Here's what I did. I kept the video from a few years ago. I think it's a pretty well-known saying by now that it's the C students who run the world, and I'm pretty content with that statement. We seem to be doing just fine with that, somehow. Going to college does not reflect your own individual ability or capacity to be a good person and accomplish great things. Going to college does not make you smarter than anyone else, especially going to an Ivy League college. That's one of the attitudes held by college-educated people that's really annoying. If you don't go to college, then you're just a backwards redneck who's probably only got 3 teeth. I am an expensively educated human being. It gives these jackasses in particular a more important and self-serving role in the world. And this is the attitude that politics is filled with, where politicians and intellectuals can start spouting off about how great their ideas are compared to what works, or what evidence there is to the contrary, or the values held by other people. What do you mean, free markets? Let the people decide? You mean the market knows more than I do? You mean I don't get to control the market and nitpick it however I want? No. Clearly you don't see my college diploma. Show me your teeth. But besides all this, you're probably going to come out of it with a lot of debt, and you're 50% likely to not have a job after graduating. Only 27% of graduates get a job in the field they got their degree in. Don't get a worthless degree. Get the skills that people will pay money for. If there's one thing you have to do, acquire the skills that people pay money for. But for now, I'm going to at least complete another school year. And it's not like it's terribly difficult at all. Honestly, all of the AP classes I took in high school were way more difficult than what I'm doing now. College is kind of a joke. My senior year high school schedule of this is so far more difficult than anything I've ever done in college. So, are you a prospective college student and looking for some drugs, alcohol, and partying? Are you looking to smash some basic bitches and live that stank-ass life? Are you looking to trash the building you live in at the expense of your neighbors, janitors, and the university? Or just looking to be indoctrinated by a bunch of dope-ass communists? Then come on down to the University of Oregon, the best meningitis infection of your life.